Picks and Bans with CJ Entes versus KT Rollsters. And the first ban has yet to be chosen.
Just going to wait on that. Will Arrow go back to the Kog'Maw? KT can play some Protect the Kog'Maw compositions, as we've seen. And there's the Annie actually banned against Pickaboo, something that we've been seeing more banned on blue side these days. Not really first pick worthy, but definitely first pick on red side worthy.
Yeah.
And it's becoming increasingly popular in terms of priority. There is Maokai, of course, one of Someday's most influential champions on the game. Gragas going to be banned out. Score, not so much a Gragas player.
Yeah.
Ambition is, however.
Yeah, and Gragas is such a versatile champion. He is strong. He has a strong early game. He has a strong late game. Very big, beefy front line, and just synergizes with so many different team compositions as well. So I think it's a good ban that KT Rollster gave out. As long as, you know, if Score isn't so comfortable on that champion, and Ryze taken out next.
Yeah, Ryze actually banned on the blue side. Reminder: we are on Fatch 5.12, but we've seen some very impressive Ryze game so far. Even yesterday, Kuve from Samsung carrying very hard on that champion. So in spite of the nerfs, he remains ban-worthy for the most part. Now, is the Alistar going to go down here, or will it be the Evelynn?
Okay.
Bit of a surprise, because actually Score usually is the one to have Evelynn banned against him.
Yeah.
And that'll maybe lead to this Rek'Sai first pick.
Well, so if CJ Entes ends up going with this Rek'Sai, I feel like KT Rollster might take Lee Sin in response just to match that aggression. And Score has played Lee Sin this season.
Also the possibility that he goes for an Echo here, which is something that, like I said, is rising in terms of its popularity. And you can see the flash of the Yasuo from Someday reminding CJ of their last defeat. And that will be an Echo lock-in. And also the Azir.
Very early
coming
pick.
Through. Well, most teams ban Azir against CJ because Coco is amazing on that champion, so you have to take it early, I feel.
Okay. Well, then let's see the next set of champions that CJ Entes wants to take in their turn of the draft, and looks like Alistar being covered right now.
Yeah, Alistar, of course, strong pick. Want to take that one early if you can get it. Pickaboo still has that Thresh, which he can do quite well with. Also, they could just take Janna and play a Protect the Kog comp here with the Azir very easily.
Definitely. So Rumble and Alistar look like the hovers. CJ Entes still has 15 seconds.
Yeah, the Rumble for Helper, he just didn't have a great Rumble game.
Yeah.
Against Jhin Air. He missed a lot of equalizers, actually. Looked like it might be a nerves issue. Maybe he's calmed down in the booth now that it's just going to be his second time in there as a professional player.
But I have to say, though, his equalizers got better as the game went on.
They did, but there were some pretty...
Yeah.
There were some stinkers early.
That mid-game, you know, equalizer that I, you know, the NA equalizer right there. But, I don't know. I feel like since he's debuted now, that he'll his nerves have been settled a little bit. So, all right. But Janna and Gnar are the hovers.
So almost certainly a Kog'Maw coming in here for KT. They're just waiting to see what the bottom lane is going to be to make sure they can get away with it. But heavy carry protection, huge zones, and disengage from, of course, the Azir and the Echo. They have a very substantial front line. And CJ, they're so far reliant on Madlife's Alistar for their primary engage. Interestingly, Sivir falling very far down the draft. Sivir would be a good pickup for CJ Entes here.
So they might take the Kog'Maw away.
No, they're not going to take the Kog'Maw. They're trolling with Kog'Maw and Draven because they know what's coming. It's going to be one of those two.
Yeah.
But the Kog'Maw take here, CJ doesn't have a lot of peel for Kog'Maw with this composition. So taking it away would be a little bit risky. Of course, the Runeglaive Ezreal double poke could be the name of the game for CJ Entes. Coco, a player who is very good on these long-range champions, and I'm sure his Ezreal would be surprising.
Sivir.
I think Sivir Ezreal is a much better choice for them.
Yeah. If they had taken Corki and gone for the classic poke comp right there with the poke mid lane and Corki, they would have had way too much magic damage, and it would have been pretty easy to itemize against them.
Yes, I agree. And also, you want the Sivir to be further forward with this style of composition. You want to go for that mid game. And you need more all-in. You need more engage tools because of how much disengage KT has already selected. So having that Corki and trying to play poke wars against Azir and Kog'Maw with a Corki and an Ezreal may not be the best choice here.
But Runeblade of Ezreal still does a lot of damage, so... Well, so CJ Antis currently...
Oh, jeez.
We're gonna enter the League of Draven today.
Oh, boy.
Well, okay, so to be fair to Arrow, Draven is a very good matchup against Sivir. Very, very good.
Yeah.
It favors the Draven very heavily, especially with the Janna protecting him.
I don't disagree with you,
Barry.
I just see that if there's a lane swap here and the Draven doesn't get going, and we see one or two Draven games out of Arrow every single season, and yes, he's a great Draven player, but it is so hard to win in the competitive scene with Draven. And sure, he's got a lot of peel here, but CJ also has a ton of mid-game damage to punish the Draven pick. I am just unconvinced. I mean, sure, if he goes off this game, it's going to be easy because he has so much protection that he's just going to hammer through the CJ lineup. But if he can't get those early kills or get that early dominance, it's going to be very problematic for KT.
Yeah, and KT lacks that reliable hard engage. So primary hard engage, rather. So we'll see if they're able to do what they want to do with this composition.
Well, they're basically reliant on Edge if they want to engage. And beyond that, they're going to have to focus mostly on kiting or just straight up winning the laning phase, which is a possibility. I mean, we take a look at the lane so far. Gnar should have the advantage on Rumble. Azir should have the advantage on Ezreal early. So standard lanes favor KT. Let's see how it goes. Get into the game. KT versus CJ.
Alright, so we have the new pool party skins out today with Draven and his little squeaky axes.
And Rek'Sai as well.
Oh, man. My favorite thing about the Rek'Sai skin is the little tugboat he rides when
the
he goes.
The jet ski. It's not a tugboat.
It looks like a tugboat to me. I don't know. It makes a tugboat sound.
Have you ever seen a tugboat?
And it just said, well, today looks like a good angle for chicken. And I think that was his gamer tag, Crazy Boy or something like that. That's what I could decipher from that one, Monte Cristo.
It is a good day for chicken.
I want some chicken right now, actually.
Well, you can't eat while you cast, Barry. That's one of the first and primary rules of being a caster. I'm sorry.
From fossils to gasoline. I have no idea what that was referencing. Alright, so looks like that KT is preemptively trying to call a lane swap.
Yes, they definitely are trying to call the lane swap, but unfortunately, this is not going to work out for them, and this is a very good situation for CJ Entis.
Yep.
The standard lane's definitely highly in favor of KT, and you know, Peekaboo not really on a support that he's going to be able to easily roam into lane with to affect the situation in these other lanes, but maybe Arrow can punish Helper if he's in that 1v1. We do see the freeze going for Arrow, and then Janna going for a little trip through the jungle right now onto the other side, and Alistar looks like it's going to be a little bit late. Madlife will be a little bit late to disrupt the blue.
Well, Ambition finally learned his lesson and didn't start on the side of the jungle that his duo isn't on.
Yeah, well, Madlife here now. Whoa, someday getting a little bit low. He's going to be Meganar soon enough, however, and Madlife, he's about 50% of his HP. Madlife not able to take any of those little golems either, so...
Also not the best for that, in my opinion.
I mean, if you can get in there and harass early, you're going to be all right, but the blue was already dead by the time he got there, so Madlife a little bit delayed. Not expecting the lane swap to occur, whereas KT much more on the ball. So someday comes in with the teleport after that, and Ambition now on the top side, just going to be there to protect, possibly. Peekaboo sticking for a while in the lane, actually, just hiding in the brush. Well, that's interesting.
Arrow goes down to place that ward, And CJ seems to suspect that something's going on in the brush right there.
Yeah, Helbert's taking a little bit of damage from Peekaboo. Peekaboo has to back off with his shield. But otherwise, they will get this freeze. Peekaboo just playing around with the Rumble right now to make sure that he can't move forward, get any kind of gold or experience, or break the freeze that's developing. And this is going to mean that Draven will get a lot of stacks before he actually gets into a position to kill someone. And that is very scary. They have to kill the Draven, because if out of a lane freeze the Draven comes through, that's going to be pretty problematic if he gets that first kill.
So if you're CJ Entus right now, well, it looks like Ambition making waves into the top lane, and he is probably going to try to help break this freeze right now.
He's just here to break the freeze. There's not really a lot of kill threat from him and Helper at the moment. They know he's there, so Helper just going to try and get some CS while they push back Peekaboo and Arrow just a hair.
Right, and in the bottom lane, Someday went Meganar. He's going to be transitioning out of that very soon. And Score making his way down there as well. So both junglers trying to help their top laners right now break freezes.
Yeah, forcing them to take a little bit of damage from these minions, but Peekaboo and Arrow still going to hold on to the freeze in the end, keeping it outside of the turret range. So not really a very successful mission.
Ooh,
right there. Here we go. Space getting caught. There's the parallel convergence. Mad Life is stunned significantly. Is that going to be the first blood? Score dives in. It isn't enough. They back out under the turret. Someday doesn't want to flash. They got two summoners out of the bottom side.
Yeah. And Helper in trouble here right now.
There's the exhaust. Spinning Axe is coming in. And Ambition going to pop out of the ground. There's a flash.
My.
Arrow really wants it. Just trading flash for flash. They're in the minion line, though. They have to be careful. Arrow saw the skirmish on the bottom side and wanted to go ahead and take a risk. Score coming back around now. Parallel Convergence is going to be blocked by the spell shield from Space, but there's the Womp. Someday and Score get first blood as Echo doubles back around through the Tri-Brush for the kill onto Space. Great gank from Score.
Yeah, CJ Entus also should have expected him to maybe possibly make a comeback in that lane, but Ambition also been sticking around in that top lane for a very long time, so almost no trouble for KT Rolster in that one.
Right, and you have to expect that. They burned two summoners for nothing from KT, so why not just come and make another play? And because Ambition is just showing on the map constantly, there's no threat. If you look right now, Edge is having a good time in the mid lane, just keeping him bottled up, and nice delay from Peekaboo.
Yeah.
That is very annoying. He is really, I mean, KT has tied up Ambition in this top lane without doing much of anything for a long time.
Yeah, and the CS difference is starting to show along with the items as well, and both junglers are opting for the Stalker's Blade today.
Now, on that all-in, you can tell how desperate Arrow and Peekaboo were. They used three summoners, and they only got a flash out of Helper. So it was a nice defense, legitimately, by CJ to make sure that this Draven didn't pick up an early kill as he comes back to lane with a Vamp Scepter. But that is still a bit of a rough situation because KT was kind of making aggressive plays on both sides of the map, and that's really what this composition allows them to do. Coco isn't going to have a chance to roam against the Azir for a while until he actually gets that Runeglaive and is able to use the AoE from the Q on Runeglaive to clear out the wave more effectively, as well as getting the smite. So it's going to be a bit dicey for a while, but KT playing appropriately aggressive.
Yeah. And we'll also have to see if Coco decides to opt into the Ranger's Trailblazer as opposed to the Skirmisher's Saber that some people have been kind of switching between.
I think you have to go Trailblazer against this Azir.
Yeah.
I don't think you have a choice. Otherwise, you're going to lose your tower.
Definitely. All right, well, even with all that happening, Ambition's still up in experience over Score, level 5 to level 4.
Well, he was in lane for longer, so that is a big factor right now. Someday just throwing some houses, keep the wave off of his turrets. Helper actually slightly ahead in terms of CS. He has had Ambition there in the lane constantly, just zoning for him, so he was able to walk up, take a little bit more. But this has been a little bit of a weird game so far, Barry. We don't normally see this much jungle action in the lanes early in a lane swap.
Yeah. Usually you see the supports moving, making their way towards that one of the top laners that was getting denied. And I think maybe this might be a result of both lanes being frozen, because sometimes teams just tend to, one team tends to want a fast push, one team wants a freeze, so then you get this weird dynamic that builds up.
Sure. And a big part of that, too, is that Rumble is ranged, so yeah. that KT felt more comfortable having Someday try and break the freeze a little bit more by himself in that scenario, whereas basically Ambition wanted to go into the top side to assist Helper. And I think that's one of the things with Helper being a rookie as well. Maybe they're less confident in his ability to deal with this lane swap, and so Ambition trying to give him a little bit of a boost in a tough situation. Now, Pink Ward in the brush, he knows Ambition is there, but there's not going to be a play made. He and Peekaboo going to go in, though. Ambition going to have to back off, gets hit by the slow.
He can easily get out.
Yeah, Peekaboo, you know, maybe could have recalled and gone a little bit earlier there. Score had got the information with that Pink Ward, didn't want to take the red buff, didn't want to play quite that risky. I think he probably could have gone for it, considering that Edge has control over mid, but
yeah,
it's all right.
We'll see what... It looks like there's going to be a blue buff contest right now for CJ
KT
Rolster on CJ Entis's blue buff. They get rid of that pink ward there.
Okay, parallel convergence coming in. Now Score going to hop forward with the Time Winder in the phase dive. Nope. Has to back out. Edge is there. They're going to grab the pink ward, and Score will have a good time clearing out some of these tunnels to prevent Ambition, and they're just going to decide to trade blues. This is definitely the way you want to play it right now.
Yep.
If you're CJ, you're not really going to be comfortable walking into your own blue side, but no problem with going ahead and taking a blue buff away from KT while Sivir has completely zoned Someday off of the tower.
Yeah.
And look, TP coming in, and they're going to dive Helper. There's the equalizer. It already cleared out the wave. They've got to wait. Can they prevent him from going through? Score coming around the outside. They want to bottle him up. They're going to dive him anyway. Helper getting low. Score is going to pick up the kill in the end. And very low. Probably single digit HP right there. Peekaboo did tank most of those turret shots. Coco doesn't have True Shot Barrage. Now he's got it.
Well, I don't think he's going to get much of anything with that one.
He's going to clear the wave. So that does something, but Draven not getting the kill there, unfortunately. That is what they were really looking for.
And KT Rolster invested so much in that, too. They invested that teleport, and so CJ will have that teleport advantage and takes a dragon off of it.
And a tower, tier 1 tower on the bottom side. So they really committed to that. Helper's use of the equalizer on that wave bought him enough time. And now Edge going to go and bounce Coco up, but the teleport is coming in from Helper. They need to leave.
Teleport
it gets canceled in the end. But Peekaboo missed his tornado after the Emperor's Divide came through.
Well, Coco, I think, will be fairly safe right now and can finish up this wave and possibly head back. His ultimate is up, so he won't have any trouble clearing out the wave should it be pushed back in.
Yeah, so Arrow still looking for that Bloodthirster, but KT, you know, we take a look at this so far. The gold is actually relatively even. Those two kills doing work to make up for the lost turret, but CJ still playing a cleaner objective game so far, but how long? Because KT still has a pretty nice pressure edge here, and they're not able to do much to keep these champions off the turrets. And you know, Space has to be pretty worried right now about Arrow now that they're in the 1v1. We now have the lanes that KT wanted. And KT fearless about playing forward even with that turret down, because since they have control over mid, you can see Score and Peekaboo doing such a great job of warding that side of the jungle.
They have so many wards in CJ Entis' jungle. They know exactly what's going on at any given moment where Ambition is going to be as well. So there's just no surprises that CJ Entis can give KT.
And Coco just out of mana right now, while Edge just pushes forward, constantly getting damage onto that turret. So KT, and this was one of the big... Madlife gets caught. He went into the wrong side of the jungle without that vision, gets knocked up by the tornado. Space is there, but not going to land the boomerang blade, and he has to leave Arrow alone. There's some more money for Draven on the solo turret kill. And when we saw KT versus Najin, oh, Jesus, constant action. Ambition's going to get out, though.
Yeah, CJ Edmonton just can't move past their river at all. They are not even safe in their own jungle right now.
No, and this is what the standard lanes, the pick and ban did for KT. CJ had more freedom early, but now it's becoming harder and harder. Runeglaive is done, though, so that's going to buy them a little bit of breathing room, even though there's not much HP left on that mid lane turret.
Yeah.
Now, when we watched the KT versus Najin game, one of the things that we noticed that KT remarkably improved on was deep warding. Score and Peekaboo work really well together at that.
Yeah, and Janna, great for deep warding as well. So much movement speed, especially if once you get your boots of mobility. And right now she only has just the boots, the regular boots. But even with that, just leveling up the W lets you move so quickly in there. And Echo has a lot of ways to get out in case he gets caught while warding as well. So, yeah, these two players just really just dominating CJ Entes in terms of vision right now. And that pink ward at the red buff is still up for KT Rollster.
Well, basically, CJ can't walk there. And yeah, they know they can't walk there, because if they walk there, they just simply do not have presence. And Score has been just running circles around Ambition this game when it comes to jungling. So looks like they just going to back off right now, try and get the Scuttle Crab instead. They'll finally clear out that pink ward that you mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Well,
that was a value ward, though.
Lasted there for a good, I think, 7 minutes, 7 minutes plus. Well, Arrow just getting those stacks on stacks. But will he be able to cash in is going to be the big question. KT really wants to you know, get him that gold lead, but a lot of investment and just no return so far.
No return so far, but he just needs that one kill. The Bloodthirster done. He's going to be in a nice power spike by the time the dragon comes around, because more than likely Space is not going to finish that Infinity Edge, and that is taken by
CJ, I think.
Yeah, CJ looks like they grabbed it in the end.
KT Rollster looks like they want to push mid now.
Well, they need this turret down before the dragon strikes. That will make their lives a lot easier, and it is so low. They just need a couple hits, and Arrow can go ahead and tank the turret a little bit with that Bloodthirster shield A-OK.
Yep. Well, meanwhile, Space is just going to push up the bottom lane, and KT is heavily investing on the top side of the jungle with Dragon coming up in a minute and 30. I'm not sure if this is the right place you want wards right now.
Yeah, they don't have... KT doesn't have the best vision. A lot of that was cleared out, and Space going to go ahead and start the blue buff. So what is KT going to do? They could just try and push mid and top and get two turrets in exchange for the dragon, but
yeah,
I think they may be hankering to fight. They've got some nice item power spikes going, and Coco isn't that strong yet.
No, he is not. He doesn't have very much AP, but he can still get a lot of poke off, especially with the Ionian Boots of Lucidity right now.
Score's going to pop through the wall onto the Gromp. Doesn't want to box in Helper underneath his turret quite yet. That's going to be... Score.
That's some good damage.
Yeah, Score needs to be very careful about that.
Well, Helper also worried about the Echo ultimate, so didn't go for the all-in, I think. And meanwhile, CJ trying to give KTs get a bit of their own medicine.
Well, they've got to push out now. The mid turret remains standing, so that is very helpful for CJ Entes, as they have the vision control and they have the pressure on the bottom lane.
Yeah, oh, so that's a lot of damage this early.
That is a lot of damage. He's not going to have it up for the dragon fight if it occurs. Wow. Mass recall from CJ right on dragon spawn. They are very confident. They do have the void rush to get back there, but...
Well, both teleports are up for both top laners. And looks like KT Rollster starting to make some plays for vision right now. Ambition. Just making sure where KT are.
That was very bold from CJ to recall right then. They were very confident that KT was not going to go in without first pushing out the bottom wave. Oh. And with the lack of vision that they had, it turned out to be a good gamble, but still could have given that dragon up for not very much at all.
And someday just showed in the top lane right as his Meganar ran out. So if there's a window for CJ to maybe go for a team fight, the window was now, I think. But someday, no longer exhausted, building up that rage.
Yeah, he's getting close, and This is what they want, and Coco is there over the wall. Bad Life still going to try and zone in the choke right now. Space coming down. Are they going to commit to this? Looks like the answer is yes. There's the headbutt pulverized. Parallel Converge is going to zone everyone out of the pit, though. Mad Life has popped his ultimate. Here comes Gnar. Someday has his rage bar full. Peekaboo playing the outside, trying to zone out the rest of the team, but Edge not able to do much, and KT just doesn't have that primary engage, so CJ able to scatter and get out okay.
Well, True Sharp Barrage goes through, doesn't do much. And KT Rollster is just going to commit to this mid push now, but against this Runeglaive Ezreal and the Sivir, I don't think they have a chance.
Well, there is no True Shot Barrage, so they only need a couple of hits. And that was, KT a little bit late to that engagement.
Yep. And Score looking for the flank right now, and the parallel convergence goes down. Let's see what they want to do. Which is KT Rollster still playing a little bit cautious.
Score's use of W this game has been very good.
Yeah, very, very good.
He's been doing it very aggressively, hitting the timings right to buy the time for the zones for his team. Mm-hmm. It's probably the best use of W that we've seen here in Korea so far that I remember.
Yeah, and here goes another True Shot Barrage over the top of the mid lane creep waves, and CJ really looking to hold this, but that mid lane turret looks like it's about to go down soon.
Score is still trying to just pressure them off the tower. Space has very little mana to keep wave clearing at the current time.
Yeah, same with Coco. And yeah, both of their wave clears down on mana, and they're still getting good poke off. Some days at half health, but we'll be transitioning into Mega Gnar very soon.
I mean, CJ has no mana. If KT commits to this for a couple more waves, they should be able to eventually get this turn. What is Space doing? Actually has to parallel convergence coming in from the outside. Flash and the Monsoon from Peekaboo. Space is certainly going down. Score picks up the kill with the Chrono Break, and there's a Gnar into the side. Ambition and Coco locked up behind the turret. And are we going to see Bad Life die? Also, yes, we will. Helper picks up Peekaboo. Helper with a double kill already. Can he get in range of Score? Actually, no. Score going to juke the other way. Gets saved by Someday, but did Arrow get a kill in any of that is the question.
No, he did not.
No, he did not.
Three assists.
Oh, he had two. He had one before. He got two assists in that dive, but they got the turret. So a favorable trade for KT Rollster, even though Helper picks up a couple of kills. However, Arrow still needs that money. And that was just such good echo play from Space. Look at, or from Score coming in. Actually gets the Chrono Breakdown and buys enough time. And Peekaboo had a good engage for the dive under the tower. Everyone lined up right there. But a five-man equalizer comes in from Helper so that he can at least get a couple of kills in that engagement. And that was a great equalizer.
Yeah, much better than last time. And KT just going for this blue buff again. That mid lane turn has finally fallen for KT Rollster, and the gold lead is in their favor by 1.4k. But CJ is still up on dragons, and I think if we have to go into late game, I give it to CJ Antis right now.
Yes, unless if you talk about the late game, they are extremely scary with the Sivir and the Ezreal. I mean, KT is no slouch in the late game either, but this Draven needs to get rolling, that's for sure.
I think he's sitting at 400 something stacks right now. Couldn't really get a good look earlier, but Coco doesn't get a blue buff, I think, so that's a little bit painful for him. But he's very close to his Luden's Echo, very, very close.
Yes, he is. All eyes on Arrow, gone for the armor penetration on the Last Whisper next. But, I mean, he's got so much gold saved up at this point with his CS scores that, I mean, if he gets a kill, that's going to be like a full item
Now.
It's going to be a lot.
It's going to be ridiculous. But Arrow just furiously farming right now. At least to try to make up for his lack of kills, but he needs to convert those stacks. He really, really needs to.
Yeah, and he was so close. The Whirling Death. Space actually had to spell shield the second tick of it coming back through.
Yeah.
Had he not done that, not been a good time for him underneath the turret. But, you know, Score, 100% kill contribution rate so far, and he's just been having an outstanding game.
Yeah, and KT looking to establish control over the bottom side jungle of CJ Antis, and they maybe want to take this tier 2, but they're just going to back off. More True Shot barraging.
No, this is the time where if you're KT, look, you have the turret advantage, you have that slight gold advantage. You need to keep fighting now before Coco gets too crazy. Yes, he's got the Echo. This is a good power spike for Ezreal, but you know, the closer he gets to six items, the more insane this Runeglaive Ezreal becomes in terms of damage. So now is the time for KT. They need to fight and snowball now off of this dragon fight. If CJ's smart, they'll just give it up. I mean, frankly, from CJ's perspective, screw this dragon. You already have two. You know you're going to get Coco to the late game. Why fight now? Go ahead. Take out mid turret. Take out top turret.
Yeah,
try and even up that gold score and just let him have the dragon.
Yeah, right now it looks to be a 2K gold lead for KT Rollster, and most of it was invested in those kills, so it equalized very quickly, as you said, once they take those towers. And meanwhile, Someday just pushing up that top wave, and both teleports are up, and dragon will be up in 15 seconds.
Yeah, Someday well itemized against the AP damage so far.
Yeah. Well, if... Well, he doesn't have any armor. Well, he has a little bit of armor. And that Sivir does have Infinity Edge, and soon to the Static Shift will follow very soon. Okay. Dragon is up, activated by CJ Antis.
I mean, I think CJ shouldn't commit to this. If you get some lucky poke,
yeah,
maybe you can go ahead and force them off, but I think committing to this dragon might be quite silly. Last time we saw Score do a great job of zoning the mouth of the pit with the parallel convergence. Someday just sitting there with nearly full rage, arrow pushing up on the bottom side, and CJ is rightfully being very tentative about taking this dragon.
And Someday in that flank right now, his rage is running low. And, well, they want to contest it, I think, CJ Antis. They don't want to give it up for free. They might be able to get a lucky steal with Coco using his Q and his ultimate. But there may be a fight that breaks out soon.
Here we go. TP coming in on the Rek'Sai tunnel. Helper is here.
Someday is in such a good position, though, even though he's only at half rage.
And there we go. Score's going to secure the dragon. Oh, CJ now trying to get out of the pit. They pop the Sivir ultimate, parallel convergence. Someday full rage. They got to be careful. Going to knock him right into Meganar. KT gets poked and starts to disengage, using those sand soldiers to hold off CJ. So nice play by CJ. Just go ahead. Now, they didn't trade. They could have just all walked into the top side of the map and tried to take down a tower instead, but they decided to go for the poke. However, they still get the disengage, and maybe, just maybe, they can take out this mid lane turret too.
Yeah, but CJ had to use that teleport, and meanwhile, Someday still has his, so there is a teleport advantage for KT Rollster, but oof.
Oof. That is the sound of watching Runeglaive Ezreal.
Yep. Well, Someday still pushing furiously. They're going to have to send someone real soon. And if they send Helper to deal with that, that could be a possible 4v5 for KT Rollster.
Someday maybe looking for a flank right here.
Yeah, he's
going to get seen in the
river. He's at 3-force rage.
Uh-oh, parallel convergence comes in, not going to hit anybody. Ambition gets jumped on with a phase dive. Madlife just going to disengage with a headbutt. They got a long way to go.
Oh,
Someday
go.
Gets it with the huge Gnarlt into the wall. There's the equalizer, but it's going to only mitigate the damage that's already done. Someday coming up with a big hop flash play for a kill onto space.
And Coco has no mana, so he can't even poke them away.
No, KT should just do Baron right now.
Yep. Well, KT Rollster, they're looking to maybe back off, but Someday is recalling, but he does have his teleport.
Yes, exactly. You know, they're trying to get the blue buff here, but you know, when you put down that Azir turret, they're going to get a tier 2. They put down the Azir turret. Let's take a look at this one again. Because Someday comes in, look at the rage timing on that too.
Yeah.
Four-man Gnarlt, and look, Edge is going to come in with his combo on Azir, and Space just doesn't even have a chance.
Yeah, but Helper really doing work to save the day for CJ Antis. He got a great equalizer in that fight.
Yeah, he did. Had that equalizer not been placed right where it was, it would have been a disaster for CJ. Now, they had the mid bottled up. They decided to go for the safe play, which was the tier 2 turret, but had somebody immediately recalled and then TP'd in, I think they may have been able to pull a Baron out of that one.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, Someday with Randuin's Omen now, he's a pretty tanky Gnar right now, and he has a decent amount of magic resist too with that Hex Trinket and that Spectre's Cowl. And Spectre's Cowl very good against poke.
Oop. Another blue buff. Not going to Coco.
Yeah, Coco's getting so denied. He's going to need some form of mana regen, I feel like, in terms of itemization at this rate. Well, they want to push Arrow away, maybe kill him and take away half of his stacks, but nope. Nothing is committed to by CJ Entis, and someday just constantly pushing.
This is the world's saddest Dravenberry. 4 assists at 28 minutes,
yeah.
And no kills.
You know, KT Rollster tried so hard to... Well, they didn't try so hard. They tried to call the lane swap. If they really wanted that standard lane, they should have gone for those deep wards at level 1.
I mean, honestly, that's not a very good insurance, but CJ may not be wanting to make this trade right now. There is an Azir on the enemy team, and there's a Sheen Draven running up the lane. They just gave up an inhibitor turret for free.
Oh, they might give up this inhibitor as well.
What is CJ doing? They really committed to that topside, but not a lot of respect.
Equalizer.
No, the inhibitor doesn't go down. They're trying to kite out. Somebody doesn't have any rage, so they just need to back off. Wow, they barely did not take out the inhibitor.
Well, CJ,
it was one hit away.
Yeah, and CJ's still chasing. But I don't know. A lot of ultimates are still up for KT Rolstick, with the exception of the Monsoon.
Yeah, you can't commit to that. Space also used his Sivir ult to get his team back to save the inhibitor, which was the difference between that inhibitor staying up and going down.
Someday
is on a secret mission through the enemy jungle.
I think Madlife is onto him.
He's going to have to kill himself.
Oh! Smart man.
And he's got TP. If he can bait Madlife into... Oh, there's a Void Rush.
There's the jet ski.
He's just going to die. Okay.
Well...
Are they going to go for a Baron in response, though?
Well, Someday's wasting so much time right now.
He's got two people down there. He's going to turn into Beginar. That's even more time. And there's the TP. There's no more crowd control. Goodbye.
Oh.
There's the headbutt. There's the Gnar. He dies.
Well, this is a power play now for CJ Entis. They can push up this mid turret.
But they only have three people there, however. Meanwhile, KT still has four in the lanes because of Someday's little adventure to kill the inhibitor. Turned out to be a good call. Someday, I guess, not really keeping track of the cooldown on that crowd control because he should have waited for both of those CC, the knockup and the headbutt slash pull to be down before trying that TP.
Well,
kind
of
a waste.
I think the reasoning was that Madlife was just probably going to sit on that headbutt for a long time, so might as well just go for it at that point.
No, because then you burn the cooldown and you put your team in a hole in terms of the TP presence on the map. So
mm-hmm.
I think you just die there, honestly.
Well, most ultimates up for CJ Entis right now. Meanwhile,
I think Arrow might be breaking some sort of Draven stack record in this game without ever actually cashing in.
I think that belongs to Cop, I think.
Never cashing in. Poor, poor Draven.
Well, sitting down. Well, we're going to go back to LoL. And while teams just kind of form a zone, but that dragon has come up now.
It's not going to be a very long lull, methinks. Especially since all those super minions are still in mid, and with the tier 1 not even destroyed yet for KT.
Well, Someday is on the side. They got CJ Entis snarled up.
Yep, and there they are. They're in the choke. They have to be careful about an equalizer. Here comes Rumble. Where is the equalizer? They're going to pop it now. Someday comes in. He gets into the back line. Space and Coco having a bit of a hard time, but Helper doing a great job of zoning on the outside. That is so much poke damage onto KT. KT just going to have to back off.
Yeah, it's not. And Coco still has a lot of mana, but
Edge goes straight into the fight. Ambition gets the kill. Arrow still killless right here. They're going to get him. Arrow falls without cashing in on the stacks. And KT gets desperate on the re-engage. Edge tries to go in and be the hero, but the rest of KT simply too low. Helper coming through for his team.
Yeah.
Had some great play in that team fight. Definitely a big change from our last match that we saw him play in.
Yeah, we had these questions about Helper, and he's just delivering so hard for CJ Entis. And he just saved the day for them pretty much with his just zoning, the equalizer, just the amount of damage he's about to put out. He's able to put out in these fights. And CJ Entis going for this dragon. Will we see a Bloodwater here? Probably not.
Indeed, we shall not. And there we go. Coco
especially with two smites on the side of CJ Entis.
Yeah, Coco with a level 16 smite, so he gets it. So let's take a look at this again. I mean, KT was just completely bodied in this choke, and the Gnarl was okay. It got space in Coco, but considering that there wasn't follow-up because of Helper's Equalizer and his Flame Spitter in the choke, and then Edge tries to get the big play. Space has a nice flash in the end, and Ambition gets the kill. And look at this. There's just no mana either on Draven.
Well, the thing about that fight is that Someday on Gnar jumped into the backline and tried to get that Gnarl, but Space with a heads-up play spell-shielded the Gnarl, and so he wasn't even knocked back. No stun, and he was able to just put out damage, and Someday had to back off at that point.
Well, this game has certainly been very intense so far. KT has the inhibitor down, but Baron goes over to CJ on the strength of that team fight, and you can see KT with a lack of engage. If you're KT, you don't want to just try and all-in on that play.
Yeah.
You want to wait for them to walk through the choke. Just go ahead and take that dragon and force them into you so you can kite, because you don't have those primary engage tools. And especially after Gnarl is down, you certainly do not want to go in on that Azir. So CJ making it look a bit easy with all the poke that they have.
And just CJ in general has very good team fighting. So I don't know if Kate... Oh, that's a lot of damage.
This is one of those times where you actually start to think, maybe I need a Will of the Ancients on my Azir. I'm not even joking. Actually, Bjergsen will do that versus like AP champions or AP poke champions sometimes, and I think that's a very good build in this situation, because you can't just go back every time you get hit by a True Shot Barrage, because with the CDR from Ezreal, you're looking at one about every 30, 40 seconds.
Mm-hmm. And we have Ambition split pushing for CJ Entis, and this mid lane turret will go down. So CJ Entis up almost over 3K, in fact, gold. And they're still looking to push. And Ambition is fairly tanky right now, too.
Yeah, and without those kills, speaking of his Ambition's tankiness,
oh my Lord,
who is going to be dealing the damage on this team? There's an Equalizer coming through. They want to engage Space on the front, but that's going to be it. They're just using it to zone off the turret while this Baron ticks down Someday.
Ambition getting low, but Someday also low himself. And even Coco's W is doing so much damage. And CJ Entis, just like that, gets two tier 2 turrets.
And a tier 1, so three towers. That helps to build up this 5K gold lead that they have right now. They've hit that late game. CJ looking good.
That was one Q.
Yep.
And they can get this turret. And will they get the inhibitor is the question here.
I like how Scorch is going to go in with the parallel conversions. Helper's going to get low right off the start. Is he going to die? He actually goes down. And there's Draven cashing in a little bit late, but he'll take the money all the same. Madlife has to use his ultimate, but it looks like they're not going to be able to actually finish off this inhibitor. Peekaboo healing up his team as best he can off of this poke.
Yeah, and Coco is pretty much out of mana at this point, so CJ Entis will back off, losing just Helper.
Well, but it's where that money goes, isn't it, in the end? And that is a lot more money now for Arrow to use. He really needed that, going to finish off his Trinity Force. That said, he's still going to have a bit of a hard time with damage. And this next dragon fight is critical. Four stacks, the possibility for CJ.
Yep.
Helper will be up. He's going to have his TP.
And that will also put a timer on KT Rollster if CJ manages to get that fourth dragon. Minute 30, and I think most ultimates are up, with the exception of the Whirling Death. True Shot Barrage will be up soon enough.
Monsoon pretty critical, though. All these ults will be up by the time the dragon starts, though. So don't have to worry too much about that. Someday getting some farm up in the top lane. We'll see what he goes back and buys. Looks like he's working on that Thornmail right now. Mm-hmm.
And Coco has so much AP right now. He's going for the Zonya's Hourglass next, just to get that another 120 AP item.
Oop.
Ooh, that hit him, but will it hit him again? No, it doesn't. That'd be actually pretty funny. He gets hit on the way back and gets hit again in the fountain.
It would be more hilarious if he died.
Yeah. Oh, man. If only. Well, Ambition, split pushing again. The waves will be in favor for CJ Entis with the way Helper's pushing up that top lane as well.
Well, Someday has Flash, and when we talk about how to shut down AP Ezreal, he's very mobile. And if you don't have targeted CC, it is problematic to get back to him. So Someday is going to have a hell of a Meganar. Oh, they're actually going to go for a pick right here. Edge, they get his flash early on. That's very important. Again, flashing for the Azir Wall is an engage tool that they have. And Coco is so free in the back line of CJ because there's just not a lot of threat.
Yep, and Coco's still at half mana, so he will be able to put out a lot of poke. And they're probably just going to get this right now.
Yeah, KT has no vision. That's going to be a free dragon for CJ. Someday can't do much of anything. He has no rage right now.
Well, Ambition leaving as a rear guard. True Sharp Barrage is gone, so KT may want to fight this.
But they're going to go. There's a Talisman getting rolling, and Score trying to make a play on the side. That is going to be a very late parallel convergence.
Oh,
not really going to do a whole lot.
Edge took so much damage from just that one Mystic shot, too.
Peekaboo. Just going to disengage with a bit of a whirlwind. And,
well,
yeah, that's it. I mean, CJ doing a great job of playing around this dragon. KT is scared, and they should be. I mean, once the APS rule gets online, it's incredibly difficult to actually team fight.
Well, Baron is up in 35 seconds, so CJ may want to look for this one as well. Maybe force a fight here if KT is just going to sit back and farm. And on Score right now, establish some vision. Not a lot. And CJ will get Scuttlecrab control.
Yep, they have all the wards, and this game started so well. Very crisp play from KT early, but they just couldn't get enough advantages. Even though they got that inhibitor down, one lost team fight. And honestly, this is just the power of the Runeglaive Ezreal right now. This champion is incredibly broken at the moment.
Well, it's also KT was playing so desperate to get, you know, arrow to cash in on his stacks, and they maybe continue some fights that they didn't need to continue fighting.
Yeah, that actually just hit arrow, which isn't a big deal because he has so much
lifesteal.
Mm-hmm. That's a person you kind of don't want to hit with that True Shot Barrage. And yes, they were playing desperately, but with KT's advantage, you'd think that they would have a little bit more leeway, but the poke just a little bit too much. Somebody going to try and make a solo play onto Helper. There's the Randuin's Omen. Helper locked up right here. I'm not sure he's going to be able to get away from this, actually.
I think Helper should have just turned and fought, but oh dear.
Misses.
That's a W gone.
Misses the stun, and here we go, the rest of the team, they want to make a play right now. They think they've got a pick, but that is so much slow coming out, and they chase Coco and Helper all the way down, but can't actually finish it off. Space all by himself in the top lane. Now, can they go after the Baron right now just to clear out the wards? They're not going to be able to actually do it.
Yep, and mid lane's going to be cleared out. Oh, nope, he misses that wave.
Desperation Baron incoming from KT. They've got a lot of damage. Someday didn't even have time to fully heal in the base. They just are going to go for it.
Boy.
So risky. So risky,
but
they're going to get it before Ambition can arrive. Big equalizer, but all those Sand Soldiers move forward. They've got some defense. Edge just trying to escape right now. Bad Life with a triple knockup. Arrow with the cleanse in the back. But
Coco's
do they have enough?
Inside.
Yeah, Arrow's going to have to get out of there. Score. Does he have enough to get over the wall? Two members of KT down. And that, oops, Someday may be the next to fall. He's got a lot of MR.
Coco's got no mana, but Someday's
he's going to get the hop
up.
He's going to be all right. The boomerang to the slow, but this is a good opportunity for CJ. They've got about 40 seconds to work with here.
But they'll be pushing up against banned up minions, so their progress will be slowed at least somewhat.
Well, if they can get this turret before those banned up minions get there, they will be absolutely fine, and they are going to grab it. So they're going to get an inhibitor, actually, for this Baron.
Are they going to rotate to the bottom side and take that open inhibitor as well? Oh, my.
Ooh, Coco nearly getting caught out there.
And here we go. They're going to go for that bottom inhibitor, and they're going to take it very quickly.
Yes, they are. Someday wants to go in for the play, though. He's got the Meganar coming through. Can he defend long enough? There he is, Meganar. They have a few more hits, and CJ doesn't want to commit to that, especially edge up in 1 second.
And also no minions for them at all. That huge, huge wave pushing in the bottom side for KT Rollster. So, Dragon. Coming up in a minute 40.
A very back and forth game so far.
And CJ Anta's just playing these fights so well. Helper has showed up today.
Yeah, he definitely has. Definitely has. Coming through when his team needed them. And his equalizers were responsible for CJ not losing fights while they tried to get this Runeglaive Ezreal up and where he needed to be. KT wants an inhibitor of their own. They have those Baroned up minion waves, but the wave clear is excellent from CJ.
They have a good mix of physical and magical damage to help take out these waves, and they have the fourth dragon stack as well. So they're just going to take out these minions super quickly.
But dragon up in a minute. The best thing that may come out of this for KT is the fact that they will have Baron in any future dragon fights.
Edge already at half health from just one True Shot Barrage.
I don't know if Madlife wants to go in on that one, actually. He's going to take a lot of damage, and he's going to lose his ult immediately. That is not a good sign if they want to fight for this dragon soon.
Parallel Convergence is down. Someday is in Meganar form, so no big fight going to happen. But topside, ooh, two super minions pushing in.
No TP for KT either, and they can't go back right now. Because if they go back, they're going to be in trouble when it comes to this dragon.
If you're CJ right now, do you want to force a fight? The Mega Gnar is down, and KT Rolster is on the retreat.
Without that Alistar ultimate, you may be a little bit more wary, but Someday has been poked, as has Edge, to about 50% HP. There goes one Nexus turret. Geez.
They have to do something right now.
Well, they can't. CJ has been great about just keeping KT in this mid lane. It's a really rough decision at the moment. What do? You have to put down the Azir. Oh, that's huge that it didn't hit Edge. They're going to go for the dragon. This is probably going to determine the outcome of this game.
They're going to lose that turret.
CJ and KT cannot leave. Their recalls are going to stop. There's the equalizer coming through.
Great.
They're going to get the dragon. Maybe. Yes, they will. KT grabs it. But can they last long enough for their Nexus not to die? Someday dies in the front line. Coco very low. And Arrow and Peekaboo has to escape. Three down. And that's going to be it. CJ's going to take this
Helper
game.
Helper should just TP right there. There he goes.
He's going to go right away for the win. CJ has some great shot calling late to hold KT in the mid lane. So a very exciting game is going to end with a CJ Entis victory.
Well played by CJ Entis. KT Rolster looked so good in the beginning, but they just got desperate, I feel like. They tried to convert these fights that they tried to take these fights that they should have just backed out of, I think.
There was really only that one fight around the dragon that they took that I think was particularly not a good idea. All the rest of them, the dives look very convincing, very clean, and KT took those edges. But Helper, he was the leg up in this composition. You take that rumble, get the mid-game power so that you can get Ezreal enough items to actually come through in the end.
Yeah, and after those stinkers of an equalizers from his last set, he's shown that he can play just as well as any other top laner in this league.
Someday. Our time after that loss for sure. KT taking that early advantage, but CJ with those early dragons, that was the big difference.
Right now.
Okay. So, what do we got here from KT Rolster? Waiting for the Bicks and Bans to come through. There is the rumble for Helper. That's a wise ban, I think.
Good ban. We'll see what Helper will default to and when. Now that that's taken off the table, Helper's only played Rumble and Maokai so far. Ezreal banned on the blue side.
Yeah, that's to be expected. If you don't want to first pick the Ezreal, then CJ actually has a lot more flexibility about when and how to pick it. Plus, on red side, if you take Ezreal in the first round of the draft, you can just flex him into the AD carry role like we saw SK Telecom do.
Yep.
So I don't know if you would ban that on red side, but certainly a very solid blue side ban.
Well, we are going to see the Kalista and Gragas banned out for CJ Entis. Kalista, that standard red side banned right now.
Yep, red side ban's the same for CJ so far as they were for KT last game. And now, what is the priority going to be? The Annie is still up. Remember, there we go.
Yep, the Annie's down. Now, Ryze or Evelynn will get through now.
Or Maokai. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's going to be, and Alistar. There's actually a lot not banned here because we have two pocket bans in Rumble and Ezreal. So we're going to see a lot of power picks in the draft.
Is Ezreal really a pocket ban? Would you consider it? It's a very strong pick right now. I would say it's a meta ban at this point.
Yeah,
right now.
That's true. Fair enough. And that'll be the Ryze. So they don't want Someday getting his hands on that top carry. Now, if you're going to pick the Azir first, okay, that's a bit interesting. Again, most teams just ban it against CJ.
Yeah.
Because Coco is so good at that Azir. So, KT, picking Azir in the first round of the draft on both red and blue side, but that's going to leave up a lot. Of course, we have Rek'Sai. We have, I mean, if I'm KT, I want Score playing that Echo again. Mm-hmm. He had a very good individual performance on Echo.
100% kill contribution, and looks like CJ may be going for the Evelynn. And Alistar are the current hovers. Well, if CJ does get the Evelynn, then that means if I was KT Rollster, maybe just take the Rek'Sai.
Yeah, exactly. That's a bit puzzling that Ambition would prioritize that champion, especially since, I mean, honestly, Ambition's not the greatest Evelynn player. He has a lot of trouble getting flanks, which is kind of a necessary prerequisite to playing late game Eve.
I mean, I think this may be just like a scrim performance thing. Maybe he just does it very well in scrims and just every time he's pulled it out in professional play, it just hasn't looked as crisp as it should.
Yeah, but again, it is a bit of a takeaway because Score draws a lot of Eve bans himself. And maybe they think if they take Eve, Score will not play Echo. He'll play the Rek'Sai instead, which maybe they think is better. I would say it's better for CJ if Score isn't on the Echo again.
Well, so we have Rek'Sai as the hover currently. And KT Rollster thinking this one over.
Yeah, there's still a lot up. I mean, where do you go? I think you take the Maokai right now for sure. I think you take Maokai and Rek'Sai immediately.
Really just test Helper's champion pool. At least put him on something he hasn't played so far.
The other option is they bait out the Maokai pick and KT has some sort of counter for someday. We've seen Marin recently be extremely successful with Fizz against the Maokai, and someday will definitely play Fizz if he has the opportunity.
Oh, yeah. Maybe the Renekton.
No more Renekton.
Renekton has a very good matchup against the Maokai, in my humble opinion, Monte Cristo. But right now, it looks like it's the Echo and Thresh, and putting Pickaboo on a playmaking champion like that Thresh could be very big for KT Rollster.
Sivir's still available, and that may be the selection for space once again. But Maokai falling very, very far down this draft, and I think CJ's very wary. I think they're just going to pick Victor right now and save their top laner so that they get a counter pick, because if you take Maokai, someday, I promise you, has something to abuse that in a laning phase.
Ooh, maybe the Gnar, though. Well,
I would just take Victor Sivir here if I'm CJ.
Yeah, because they already see KT Rollster's mid lane.
You know what the mid lane matchup is. And someday is the player that you want to neutralize the most. Especially, even though Helper did have an MVP performance that time, legitimately, he's still the rookie. It's going to be Gnar. He apparently feels safe enough on that champion.
Well, what are they waiting for in terms of the mid lane? Maybe they want to see the full composition before really gelling their lineup together.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what they're waiting for. Unless they're going to try some sort of crazy all-in champion on the Azir, but that really hasn't been popular recently. People just don't want to take that risk.
Yeah. What do you think would be a good mid lane pick for CJ Entus right now, just looking at the composition?
Maybe Coco wants to take TF again and see if he can survive the laning phase to make some plays on the side lanes.
Yeah, TF. Maybe the Varus. I don't know.
Yeah, the Varus. Again, both those champions, you're going to get poked out early by Azir.
Well, he goes for the Maokai against the Gnar. Please don't play Draven again, Arrow.
He's not going to play Draven again. I refuse to believe that he's going to play Draven again.
Looks like he might right now at this rate. Nope, the Vayne is going to be the pickup instead.
Going the Vayne, I mean, there's a lot of high HP targets here from CJ and not a lot of threat for a Vayne so far selected by CJ Entus. They don't have any of that single target lockdown, really, that proves very effective against Vayne a lot of the time. So will that come through on the mid lane pick?
Anivia?
No. That's not going to happen.
LeBlanc seems fairly reasonable.
No, she's been nerfed. She actually hasn't been played since the chain nerfs that happened a couple of patches back.
Well, currently his summoner spells are Ghost and Flash, so I feel like
I think this is a possible TF pick. for sure.
Nope, maybe it's just the Victor.
Oh, if you're going to pick Victor, why not just pick Victor earlier? This is what confuses me about this draft for CJ. It will be Victor last pick. I'm not sure what they were waiting for right there. Seems like they could have had a nice counter pick for Gnar, even though Gnar with that range is going to do just fine up against the Maokai. But Maokai is definitely one of someday's scariest champions. That's why we saw it banned out by CJ in the first game of this series, because his teleport flank plays on Maokai are among the best.
Yeah, very, very solid player in general, really, that someday. And we have the compositions locked in. So who do you like better, Monte Cristo?
They have a lot of protection for Vayne here. They have really good pick is part of it. And they have kill pressure in top and bottom. So if Score could do well in terms of his jungling, we saw him have some creative pathing and pick up the early kills in the last game, maybe they can make some plays here. Probably going to be camping for someday again. Helper is going to have to be very careful. And as for the late game, so much damage from KT Rollster. They have much better engaged this game. And it's a more balanced composition. CJ, kind of the same story, though.
CJ has a very good AoE damage comp, though. This is the big question. Can Ambition get those flanks on Evelynn? Because if he does and slows them up, then they can destroy them.
That's right. Well, let's get into game number two. Can KT come back against CJ? Let's find out.
Big cheers.
Big cheers for KT Rollster and CJ Antis, game number two. CJ had a nice comeback victory in game one with some good late game stalling and shock calling using that Runeglaive Ezreal. But that's not available this game.
Nope, it is not.
No, KT's been seen. Ambition saw people stacking up in that brush. He's remaining outside of vision range, so just trying to track Score at the moment. So he does get seen. Pings go down. So KT looking for the deep wards.
This is what I wanted to see from KT in game one, because if they really wanted to pick all of these, you know, good lane matchups, then they really should have invested, like, just like this in terms of the vision. Yeah. Just like, Gada is what Gnar says, so KT someday, and then I guess it's like a playoff of is going to play, and it's weird, because Gada is to go.
Right. So, similar warding patterns from both teams. When the CJ sees that, they immediately place the exact same ward. So we are going to see that start where this is something the Korean teams have started doing in the past. A couple weeks, SKT punished this very hard with an invade. We could CJ try the same tactic here. And looks like a lane swap going to be coming through for KT Rollster.
This is a very odd level one start.
No. This is what you do to punish this. You walk around this route, but it's gonna be seen before the red buff gets started. Now Madlife and Space in. A little bit of trouble right there as the creep spawn. Peekaboo barely missing that hook. Madlife has to flash.
Yeah, flash force, but now we'll see where these lanes end up being. It looks like it might end up being the standard lanes, but they really wanna stop.
I don't think that Madlife and Space can really stop this. I mean, with Peekaboo walking into the jungle, it would be a 3v2, and Madlife lost a summoner already, so they're just going to have to back off. Yeah. And Ambition has to go to enemy red in order to get that. And with the way it's working out with our top laners, both just going to be teleporting back in. But Maokai someday not going to be at level 2 yet. Meanwhile, Helper did hit it off of Grump and Blue Buff. So advantage to Helper early on in the laning phase.
And we're going to look at some stats now. Carry rating for the supports.
Assist per game is the statistic that they like to use for that. Mm-hmm. I don't really like that statistic for supports, but I'm not in charge of screen overlays, Barry. If I was, all of them would just say Monte Cristo is great on the lower third all the time.
Well, you do have quite the ego. That's why you have a separate Twitter account just for it.
It's not my Twitter account, Barry.
Oh, that's what you want people to think.
No, it's not.
Well, Score moving down towards his red buff, so it looks like CJ is going to get three buffed.
Yeah, actually Ambition not really making any moves into the jungle, even though he had a very good idea where everybody was. So obviously not the biggest deal in the world, and instead he's going to prioritize that Vision on the bottom side to help out his Gnar, considering that Helper is going to want to play aggressively in that lane and harass thanks to his range edge.
Yeah, that 2v2 is not going to go well for CJ Entus right now, because Arrow was up pretty much half a level as Space and Madlife entered lane. Look at them, level 3 to level 2 currently.
Yeah, and that's part of the thing. When this warding pattern goes down, so if we take a look at it, basically it covers all of the ways that the enemy can move into your jungle, is what it does, so that you can go ahead and safely take a buff, know where their jungler is starting just by inferring. Mm-hmm. And the way to counter that is to walk in at the top, behind the enemy red buff or blue buff, where there aren't going to be any wards. And we saw SKT get an amazing level 1 fight by doing that, and pretty much win the game right there. But if you mess that up, then like we saw, the duo lane gets into lane late. And because the duo was on the side for KT on that side of the map, they were basically strong side jungling right there.
Yeah.
There was the Peekaboo's hook was the major threat. So it's a very interesting new twist on level ones and early warding that we're seeing in Korea these days. And it's very new.
Well, KT Rolster at the cutting edge of level ones and Score looking to maybe make a play in that top lane, but Ambition may be mirroring that move currently, but he's going to get some deep wards down.
Yeah, they really want to use Peekaboo is telegraphing really hard. Can he actually get the kill, though? Madlife doesn't have flash. Remember, there's exhaust going down on a Madlife. Madlife getting very low. True silver bolts not going to go through thanks to the exhaust. They're trying to turn around. Here comes Ambition, but there's pings on him in the river.
Yeah. I wonder how he was seen, or maybe they just
I think they were just suspecting, actually, that was an eventuality which could occur, and they didn't want it all in, given the risk. And that's they had a pink ward, maybe.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, looks like there was a pink ward down. Well, and so Ambition still here. Score going to try for a repeat gank yet again. Madlife going to face check a brush, but Ambition's at full HP. Peekaboo has to flash out immediately. There's a flash follow. Ambition is there, grabs the lantern. Score does to get back in. Summoner heal, but Peekaboo probably going to give up first blood as Space hops over the wall with a flash.
Good flash from Space. Just knew the damage that he could put out. And he gets rewarded with the first blood. And meanwhile, in that bottom lane between the top laner, there is a 7 CS lead that's developed for Helper.
And Nagne just going to get pushed out by this Victor. Chaos Storm just used down a little bit of damage and prevent Nagne from getting close to the wave. So nice play there from CJ. They read that Score be coming back around. And since they had an HP advantage, Ambition taking a lot of damage was a bit of a mistaken all-in there from KT Rolster.
Yeah, we haven't seen much of this mid lane, but I think we can safely infer that Coco's just been hitting Nagne with these death rays constantly.
Yeah, it has come at the expense of a few CS, but that's not too high of a price to pay. Arrow left alone in the top side now as Peekaboo and Score go on a deep warding mission through the bottom side jungle.
This is they just mirrored each other's wards pretty much right now. They want to really control these blue buffs.
Yeah, they do. And Arrow playing very cautiously. Madlife in Space, they want to make a play here. Madlife's flash is back up, so he can just flash on top of Arrow.
Well, they're going to... KT Rolster going for the Scuttle Crab. They're going to get it. And they have vision on those blue buffs. They know it's up now. Helper moving into the bottom lane to catch that wave as it dies.
Yeah, easy blue buff take here for KT. Peekaboo doing a lot of roaming early on this map, leaving the Vayne all by herself.
Well, it looks
in
like
the top lane. Now, Coco and Ambition going to try and make a play on this. They're not going to get it, though, more than likely. It looks that's going to be... Where's Smite? Smite is not theirs. Score doesn't have Smite, but the Lantern. Helper tries to go forward. He wants to make a play, but gets slowed down by the Time Winder.
Ambition got the blue,
though, because, well, it looks like he just came over and autoed it, actually.
He got it with the Q.
Yeah.
unfortunate. And, well, the wards for CJ Antas just expired on the enemy blue side, but they know it's up now, so we'll see if CJ Antas decides to make a play on that side of the map.
Yeah, they can't really go onto this Gnar and Mega Gnar form, especially Arrow just only now hitting level 6. The lane swap comes through. This is going to be a dragon attempt. I don't know about this. There is someday. He's going to TP right into the dragon fight. CJ going for this with 5 members. Now Maokai's there. He's going to pop his ultimate. This is a fight. Arrow gets bounced around by Madlife, but there is a great Azir ultimate into the fray. Arrow exhausted on the backside, but Space is going to die first. Ambition 3-man play for Pickaboo, and this is going to be some great cleanup as Arrow gets lanterned in. 3 kills for none. They did not expect KT to swap their lane assignments like that and come back into the bottom side with Arrow and Pickaboo.
And Pickaboo made that huge, huge play that enabled that really. Nogne and Pickaboo both played that fight extremely well.
Yeah, Nogne got his own protection in the back of the Baron Pit thanks to the Azir wall. Mm-hmm. And then Pickaboo got some good zoning down and brought Arrow in. Space was very awkwardly positioned at the front of that team fight, trying to get Arrow, but it just wasn't enough.
Well, CJ Antas went for a risky dragon and was severely punished for it, but they're up one dragon, so not the end of the world for them.
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, they got the first blood, and those 3 kills just brought KT up to a 600 gold advantage. But as we saw in the last game, what was more important, KT's early kills or CJ's ability to continue to threaten the dragon than that fifth stack? Yeah. And that's the reason why CJ won that last game, was because of their superior dragon control and their shot calling surrounding that objective. And also Runeglaive Ezreal.
Yeah, well, we'll just leave that as a footnote there.
Yeah, the asterisk. Runeglaive Ezreal, yes. That was actually a pretty major factor in that win.
Well, it was a major factor, but, I mean, they managed to delay long enough for that Runeglaive Ezreal to be a factor, though.
Yes. Credit to them, but that said, KT just wasn't able to snowball hard enough off the gold lead in the last game. It went on to the wrong people. They couldn't get the Draven. And,
yeah,
you know, kind of as we look at where those kills went, I mean, on to Pickaboo and score isn't great for KT. Again, Arrow left killless, even the Maokai not getting a kill. So, not the best situation overall.
Well, Azir did manage to pick one up and 2 assists, so that is a hefty amount of gold. But someday, almost completing his righteous glory. So if his teleport comes back up, KT Rolster might go for a big play with that one.
So, yeah, that is righteous glory going to come through. And by the way, someday is 12-3 all time on Maokai. It is statistically his best champion.
Yep.
So it's something that we've seen time and time again. He had some great Maokai play in the summer finals of champions that he won a year ago.
Yep.
Really coming up clutch for the KT Arrows and their victory over the team that was then Samsung Blue.
Well, he won the games with Maokai and lost the games with Riven.
The game with Riven, yes.
Yeah.
That was silly. That was silly. It's not as much of an ideal pick, or was not then as it is now. I think it's viable in certain circumstances these days, but...
Well, he probably... You know, now that I think about it... I got nothing. I was thinking maybe that the Gnar, earlier Gnar pick was to kind of shut out maybe the Riven pick or whatnot, but... Well...
Interesting. So score, I don't think score was seen by that, considering that I believe the ward was blacked out by a... Oh, no, that was his lens, so
yeah,
he was seen. So lens used in the bottom side. Now lens used by Pickaboo to make sure they don't know.
Oh,
here we go. Ambition's going to pop the Agony's Embrace. Flash immediately from Pickaboo. But Coco's already roaming. Score has to chrono break back in. There's a stun coming through there with the parallel conversions, but it's just not going to be enough. Score caught out with Pickaboo in the river, not respecting the fact that Coco could have been roaming down on that side, finds 4.
Yeah, it looked like KT Rolster was trying to set up an ambush for CJ Antas right in that brush as CJ Antas came down to maybe catch the wave, but they just...
To be fair, CJ
on him.
CJ had... What the likelihood of 4 CJ players being in that location when there wasn't even remotely like a dragon to set up for yet was... It's very weird that they were there, but yeah. They were just waiting for the blue buff transfer. Maybe two of them, but the fact that Space and Madlife were also there was quite strange. I think they were going after some blue buff pressure, actually, is what they were doing. But
gotcha. Well, Nogne gonna start dirty farming a little bit. Try to really get that CS lead going. And Coco upgraded to Hex Core.
So exciting.
I know. Farmville once again. Well, we have pretty much equalized gold. Actually, no. Somebody's probably up maybe about like 300 gold in that top lane right now. But CS is fairly close.
Considering how many people got assists off of those kills, I'd be surprised if he was that far up. But yeah, he has a nice little advantage, and Maokai generally going to be the more reliable. Of course, if you can get the big Gnarl, then you look like a hero. But for the most part, Maokai is going to be the more reliable tank in the late game in terms of team fighting.
Well, as I said earlier, if Ambition can get the flanked ult engages, then it just sets up Helper so perfectly for when he's in his Meganar form, but it's just Evelynn not the best champion for Ambition.
Yeah, that's the thing, is certainly if we were talking about a player like
Chaser,
Wisdom or Chaser,
yeah.
These are guys that have proven demonstrably that they can set up the engages on Evelynn, but Ambition has been very disappointing in that department so far this season. He saw a chance to turn it around, though.
Well, he's going to get seen by that pink ward in the river brush. He's forced to back off. And it looks like KT is starting to maybe gravitate towards the bottom side of that jungle. Coco zoning out Nogne from the mid lane, though.
Yep. And so Arrow has the Blade of the Rune King right now. Ambition still wants to slow down this Vayne as much as he possibly can.
Well, he knows exactly where that pink ward was, so he's just going to sit around.
Someday is actually waiting to see if he needs to use his teleport right here. You can see him backing off into the jungle because it's unclear what's going on with Peekaboo and Arrow in this bottom side. Peekaboo can't really contest that.
He tried to go for a fake with the lantern. Good try, but CJ Antis just called his bluff.
The mind games over pink ward protection.
Well, I mean, it would have worked if CJ Antis didn't have that ward on the red buff.
Yeah. So, score. Scene. In the jungle. Not a lot of threats. So, a couple wards cleared out of Try, and Someday just playing this very cautiously right now. Backed all the way up to his turret.
CS is staying fairly even. The Righteous Glory is finished, so I think the next buy might end up being an upgraded boots with Homeguard, maybe.
That's what I would do if I was Someday.
Yeah, just go for the big, big backline plays.
That's right. Ninja Tabby, Homeguards, let's do it. Try and make the plays early on. Have confidence that your team play is better than Helper's, who's been thrust into this situation. Even though he's had some more time this week to scram, obviously, with Shy's finger injury.
And he's been looking good today, so we'll see if Helper can keep up that MVP performance from game one. But meanwhile, Dragon is live, and CJ Antis trying to establish some vision. A lot of pink wards for KT as well.
Yeah, and Helper has that pressure. He's already whittled down the top lane tower to about half health.
As Gnar usually does in this matchup.
Yep, just get a lot of that chip damage in. Although Nogne doing some work in the mid lane too. In terms of slowly moving on that tower HP. So, Someday is just threatening recalls every chance, and threatening teleports every chance he gets. He's constantly walking right back into his Tri Brush and hiding to make sure that the rest of the members of CJ Antis stay on their toes.
So, if you're CJ Antis, would you give up this dragon possibly for that top lane turret? Bait out the teleport, just disengage, and then take that top lane turret.
No, I think you can fight if you're CJ. There's a Vayne on the enemy team. Space just came back in with an Infinity Edge, so you should be good to go. Should be good to go.
Well, all ultimates up.
Ooh. Oh, there's the blade actually active, and Arrow gonna have to get ripped out of danger. Ambition waiting right there in the wings to go into Arrow, and that is absolutely massive. Arrow, he does have some sustain. He has that blade, but with the crab already taken by CJ Entis, now they have a lot of wiggle room on this Baron, or Dragon rather, and they have right away. Okay, so here come the TPs. Gnar TPing behind. Maokai TPing there as well, so there's a parallel Ambition. Convergence. Can they get anything? Ambition gets caught in the pit. He's going to die, and actually that is going to go over to Victor. Coco taking it in the end. Arrow still on the outside. Arrow has the exhaust on him right now, but it doesn't look like Mad Life's actually going to get out of that one. Amazing hook onto Helper, but Pikaboo dies in flight. Can they take out Helper before he turns into Megadar? The answer is no. Still 3-for-1, but Coco actually grabbed the dragon in the end.
Yeah, that is huge for CG Antis. It looked so bad when that started, and it still ended kind of not great for CJ, but at least they have the two dragons. Well, and let's see if they can do something here.
I don't know if you want to go on to this. Helper turns into Megadar. Score is still there. Nagne is full HP. Questionable engage.
Oh, Helper.
Ooh. Ooh. Helper. Easy there.
Playing straight on the edge. This isn't solo queue, buddy.
Yeah, that was a little pointless by CJ. Nagne was there taking the blue buff and was still full health. And considering Nagne had the flash and the heal available, they actually might have been able to chase that one down. I think KT could have gotten more aggressive there than they did.
Yeah. Well, I think they were probably pretty surprised by the fact that Helper's playing so aggressively in that situation as well. And, you know, I feel so bad for Coco this series so far. He's getting denied on blue buff so hard.
Well, I mean, you have to know that Coco is that the biggest threat on CJ. Looks like we're just going to trade turret for turret here. Pikaboo going to just walk in and chain CC Ambition. Okay.
Wow.
I mean, Pikaboo just walked up to it and inflated. Yeah. There's not much left to be said there. A misplay from Ambition.
Well, he just came back from that warding mission, so maybe he wasn't expecting Pikaboo to come from that side of the map. But that... they didn't have vision on that side, so Ambition maybe should have played a little more cautiously, and they're maybe going to give up that top lane turret as well.
Wow, this would be huge for KT. They can get two towers for one and the three kills. There's another Azir turret falling in mid. Arrow just left alone on the top side.
That Vayne, 104, is sitting on a hefty amount of gold.
Well, and Helper can't get close. He doesn't have... I don't think he has enough armor right now to really deal with this Vayne. Yeah, he does
have
working towards
mail.
The Randuin's Omen, but the all-in and the 1v1 could be very dangerous for him.
Indeed. Well, looks like Ambition is heading towards that top lane to shore it up, but three people from KT Rollster.
Uh-oh.
Ambition
scene. Uh-oh. Yep. Hook gonna miss. Ambition uses his W to get that little bit of extra speed. And now KT really wants to control the top side of the map. Someday all on his own against this Sivir, but there are four people from KT moving up towards the tier two in the top side. Coco doesn't have any mana either. This blue buff denial has really hurt CJ.
Yeah, and Coco falling down about 20 CS, and they're just denying all the buffs here today.
KT starting to really eat up the map. That is something that has become a little bit more of a specialty of KT since the addition of Pikaboo. It's just their warding has gotten so much better.
Yeah. Well, will this turn out to be like last game where, you know, CJ Antis seemed to be giving up a lot early but just managed to pull out that win just through superior shot calling and the asterisk brokenness of AP Ezreal with Runeglaive.
Well, I think KT learned their lesson. They can't give up so many early game dragons again, and they're in a situation now with the gold lead where they should be able to fight. This Vayne has the Phantom Dancer, and there's a nice delay from Pikaboo. Someday gets the tower in the bottom side, so just like that, CJ losing their entire outer ring of turrets. Even though arguably they have the better wave clear in this game, Arrow doesn't even have a static shiv.
Yeah, he just went straight for that Phantom Dancer. Wants to maximize his damage.
Well, and you ask how this you have to ask when this situation arrives too. How does that happen? Because how it's happened is that it's just been warding. The deep wards from Pikaboo and Score have given them so much information about where CJ is that they're able to pressure the objectives. CJ's in a situation where they have deep wards on both sides of their jungle simultaneously, so that gives KT so much wiggle room with where they assign lanes, how they allocate people. It allows them to maximize their farm and to push up the lanes safely. So CJ, in spite of having the better champions for controlling the waves on the map, haven't been able to do it because KT simply has more data to draw from.
The all-seeing eye of KT Rolster, and Helper just trying to push up in the bottom lane. And he's gonna do fairly well. Let's see how much chip damage you can get onto that bottom tier 2, but looks like this top tier 1 is the current objective for CJ Entus.
Yep, not much health left there, and no one on the defense, and even if there had been, Arrow could not defend that with just his PD Vayne, but PD Vayne means you're going to give up some of those towers. You have to say, well, I'm just going to lose this. The trade-off is I'm going to be super powerful in the late game, and I'm going to be able to deal with the big tank line of Alistar, Eve, and Gnar that's coming through, because that's obviously going to be superior in these team fights. But that also means that KT has to fight this next dragon very well.
Yep, 15 seconds. Another blue buff denial. This is...
Hey, look at
such well done.
Score and Peekaboo are just there every single time together.
Yeah.
The synergy, I'm just trying to think about if this KT team, by the time they make playoffs, if they do, how good they'll be looking together. Helper getting caught out. There's a box on the other side of the wall. He wants to just draw Helper in. There's a Lantern. Arrow going to pop up at the top. And there is a nice flash flay. But it's not enough to keep Helper in place. Maokai now just going to get some damage down onto Bad Life's Alistar. Remember, somebody doesn't have a lot of MR yet, so that Victor going to be a little bit of a threat. Whoa. But two ults popped, or an ult and a flash, rather. And that means KT can just set Arrow onto the Dragon by himself. CJ wants to try and threaten the Baron and hide in that brush, but nope, not going to work. So Dragon to KT.
Yeah.
Nice split from KT.
Well, Helper just got a little bit ahead of himself, and someday pops a Righteous Glory, maybe tries to make a pick, but Helper just easily hops out of that. And now they're looking to siege this bot, this mid tier 2.
Yeah, this
goes up.
This is not going to work for them.
They don't
With Sivir and Victor standing there, there's no chance really that KT can actually successfully complete this siege with a Vayne and an Azir being the primary damage dealers to the turret.
Well,
they want to dive, it's one thing. They want to dive, it's one thing. So they're looking for that angle, and you can see that CJ's playing away from the Sand Soldiers because it could be bent into a very scary, they're going to try for the pick on the backside, threatening with the parallel convergence, and oh wow, they're going to get in, that was some very good zoning to get some damage down onto the turret, actually. Well, the parallel convergence and Peekaboo's presence used to scare them off, but it's still not a lot of damage.
Well, Helper's back in the mid lane, joined his team, but his rage bar is fairly low. We'll see how quickly he can get that up so his KT will be scared away.
Sidewave pressure is in favor of KT, so they just need to sit here. They don't necessarily need to do damage to the tower at the moment.
All right, more wave for coming out. Someday threatens with the Righteous Glory.
Score actually gets bounced around by Bad Life. Helper's coming in. Helper is exhausted on the front line. Peekaboo, the first to die. Ambition actually finds the flank. Someday low. They have to back out of this right now. Someday has to flash. And Coco still chasing.
Ooh.
As the Death Ray doesn't get the second hit on the Death Ray. And that's going to be it. Score trying to TP out. He does get out in the end. And he's not going to use his ultimate to get back. And CJ just doesn't have the chance to push forward in the mid lane.
Yeah,
nice flank from Ambition.
Yeah, Helper try to jump ahead and try to chase after Score, which I think was kind of maybe the wrong play, because I don't know what he was thinking, that he could maybe just kill him outright. I think he would have been better served just staying in the middle of the team fight and possibly going for a Gnar ultimate. Helper didn't use his ultimate in that fight. So
no, he didn't really have an option to.
Yeah. He got exhausted pretty much instantly, I think.
Yeah, and there's also, I mean, the Vayne Condemn can push him back too, if necessary. So Helper is going to have a difficult time getting into position, but Ambition actually coming through with the flank this time, and that was what set up the kill.
Yep.
And if we look at the itemization, Peekaboo actually has Frozen Heart here. So two Frozen Hearts, they're trying to slow down the Sivir, but Victor's still going to be doing a lot of damage.
Yeah, we'll see.
Not much MR yet.
Oh, okay, Mad Life went for the engage.
Yeah, but there's the TP. Ooh. Ambition just gets caught and destroyed. Arrow with the kill. They thought they had a pick right there, but Peekaboo just dropped the box, and that was it. Helper too late to save his jungler. Ambition not even using his ultimate. Thought they had an easy kill, but wasn't so simple with the invade from KT. They have control over the Baron currently. They want some more picks. And remember, somebody doesn't have TP, so it's going to be a 4v4 at this Baron.
Arrow just lurking in that top side of the jungle, maybe possibly going for a pick, and he...
Oh!
Yep.
Okay, well, Arrow finds himself that 1v1 kill in spite of the fact that Helper has both Randuin's and
a Thorn Mail.
Thorn Mail already.
Jeez, that true damage doing work.
Yeah, definitely, and he has enough lifesteal to kind of get through it, at least for the moment. He doesn't even have, I don't even know how that happened, he doesn't even have any armor penetration.
Probably just started with a good condemn, I would assume.
Yeah, must be.
And along with the AD boost Vayne gets from her ultimate, so, well, CJ on the back foot.
And KT, they want this 1-3-1. Without TP up, they have that advantage in a 1-3-1 split push. And so that requires Victor to go down. We saw what happens when they group. It's just even when they played that siege pretty well in the mid lane in terms of just coming in and getting damage, they didn't actually have enough to chip that turret very severely, and it ended up kind of getting them killed in the end. So the split push, making sure Sivir and Victor can't be in three places on the map at once, very crucial. Mm-hmm. And they get some good minion wave pressure and a kill out of it in the end. So their wards around the Baron have faltered, though, for the time being, as they start to recall, go back, pick up some more items. Arrow now with the Last Whisper. That is huge.
Yeah, and he's just going to shred through that Gnar.
Oh, man, triple Frozen Heart on KT. And wow. Still space. No Last Whisper. He's close. But who is Space going to kill here? He's basically useless at the moment.
Well, we're going to have to see how much work Coco can do. And even Coco's just been so denied this game. Like, even though he's keeping up in CS, he just hasn't had that blue buff to constantly just spam out death rays in these fights. He just runs out of mana so quickly.
I'm actually wondering if Coco is going to have just an absolutely massive ult here, because KT has to be really careful. They don't have MR. Oh, Helper has to flash Peekaboo again. Helper not looking so great on the Gnar this time. It's just he's been out of position. He hasn't been respecting where people can be on the map, and neither is Ambition for that matter. Ambition 0-4-2 in this one. Not a great stat line. He's been caught out quite a bit.
Nope.
Dragon number two, maybe in the pocket of KT Rollster, is just going to be Arrow. He's going to be perfectly safe doing it alone, considering the wards and the teleport advantage that KT have. So they're just going to hold on to their vision at the Baron while doing the dragon. Very well played by KT.
Yeah, Shot Caller looks a lot more crisp. They're not playing as desperately as they did in that first set. And Coco trying his best. CJ is holding on, but I think this Baron bait might end up going through. They can take this very, very quickly, I feel.
Well, CJ is going to have to engage at some point. Actually, Score going to be the one who goes in first with the Time Winder. Just wants to protect his wards. He's just going to walk forward, not afraid of the damage that's coming through. There's a Chrono Break.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, there's the Chrono Break on the way back. So, ooh, a little bit close. A little bit close, but someday gets some more time in the bottom side while that occurs.
Well, that is the jungler forced out, so CJ still in no position to maybe threaten that Baron.
It was a really good ult trade, though. Getting Coco's ult out for Echoes is absolutely huge on a team that doesn't have an Aegis or a lot of MR.
I wonder who's going to even build that Aegis of the Legion. Probably, I would assume, the Echo. Oh, here they go.
Yep, TP going in. They want to take this. Arrow's already at 50% HP. Took a few Baron shots. And now, someday, going to eat a death ray from over the pit. Are they going to be able to get this? Box already down. They've got the zone. Yes, they will. There's no way for CJ to get in. They're going to try and T5 right afterwards. Space free in the back line. Coco getting tied up by Someday. Someday just all over Space and Coco at the backside. Vayne still very high HP. Someday not dead yet. There's Someday. He's going to take out the Gnar. And it looks like it is 1-0. No, double kill, actually. Helper escapes in the end with just a sliver of HP.
Helper played that fight extremely well. He got that good Gnar ultimate into the W stun on Nogne, and score, I think. Vayne was still doing damage, but I think just couldn't find a good position to really lay the hurt on CJ Entis.
Yeah, that's right, and Helper actually managing to get out in the end is pretty nice. Mm-hmm. And also, killing the Maokai, pretty important while that Baron buff is up, because KT, again, they're going to want a 1-3-1 here with that Baron buff, and now there won't be Baron-empowered minions while they're doing it with Maokai. And CJ has TP advantage, so I'm not sure KT's going to be able to do a whole lot with this Baron, because the Victor and the Sivir, again, still going to be so useful in defending these turrets.
Definitely. And, well, KT just establishing vision. Maybe they'll be able to get a good flank, possibly, and maybe dive this bottom tier too as Arrow pushes it up. But Helper just going to push up that top wave. Meganar is down. This may not be ideal for CJ Entis.
I don't know if they want to dive this, though. Nogde.
Someday's so tanky, though.
Someday is very tanky, and they do have a lot of zone on the back.
Dear.
Wow, they just space, just not even there. Can't get it down. Just an absolutely free inhibitor turret. CJ has been having a problem giving these up today.
Yeah, out rotated. And they get that inhibitor, and they're backing off. Well, can Helper get this top lane tier two? I don't think so.
Well, they have an empowered recall. They can send somebody back.
Yeah. Well, it looks like KT Rolster just want to control this blue buff even more and possibly threaten the bottom side tier two.
Yeah, Helper wisely, I think, backing off right now. Maokai zipping up into the lane with those home guard boots. And KT, if we talk about how they took that inhibitor, so KT was just trying to threaten the... to get in between the inhibitor and the second, or the tier two tower in the bottom side. And so they had the rotational priority by that, because there were too many people from CJ trying to defend the tier two. And CJ, without Helper being there, it was a 5v4 situation, so they had to back off. But that said, CJ could have absolutely saved that inhibitor simply by giving up the tier two in the bottom side. It was really an unnecessary trade from them.
Yeah.
And we've seen them make bad, they made that very bad turret trade call in the first game too, giving up the mid inhibitor again for just not much of anything. So I think they're getting a bit greedy in how they trade on the map. Because they certainly have the tools to defend even against a Baron up KT.
Yeah, they definitely do. Well, super minions starting to pour in through the middle lane, and KT establishing once again excellent vision.
Their warding has been very good tonight. And CJ, they have everyone there, but Baron up minions. Madlife gonna get grabbed, but he is tanky enough not to take too much, and no real damage onto the turret.
Well, Sivir does have that last whisper, but KT has such a positional advantage right now. They have the flank option. They have the Azir that could come through right now, potentially.
Well, and it's a huge problem that CJ doesn't have a natural frozen heart builder on this team. Wow, nice knock-up. There's not going to be any kind of follow-up, really. Evelynn is just not in a position to actually engage this team fight.
Yeah. I'm guessing the only person that could really get the Frozen Heart would probably be Madlife on that Alistar.
Exactly, but against an Azir and a Vayne, that is a really important item to cut out KT's damage.
Yeah, I agree, but looks like KT just slowly pushing this up. They're probably going to get it on this push.
Yep, and right as Dragon comes live, so KT has an opportunity just to back off. CJ not going to be able to contest this. And KT actually going to go ahead in Dragons for the first time in this series.
So what can CJ Entis do? KT looks like they have a much better composition than CJ does for the late game. The only hope I see for CJ is if they get a big, big fight in which, you know, Ambition comes in with that flank and Helper just destroys everyone with that Gnarl with on top of the Boomerang Blade coming in. But that's just so many things that have to go right for CJ Entis in order for them to really, you know, turn around this hole that they dug themselves into.
I agree, Barry. And I think that if CJ hadn't lost the mid inhibitor, they would have been able to do okay in this game, and they would have been able to bounce back. But now that their base has been cracked, because their primary their primary strength against KT was that it was very hard for KT to siege them, but now it's not, because they could just break the base whenever they want at this point and dive them for free. So I think the misplay where they didn't defend that inhibitor turret is going to be absolutely massive here.
Yeah.
And also, Arrow has a Banshee's Veil now, so even under that situation that you're describing, well, maybe Ambition could get the flank. With Veil, he's just not – his Veil's going to block that. He's going to flash, and Helper will not hit him.
Yep.
So as long as Arrow doesn't misplay that, he should be able just to kill the Gnar.
Oh, Peekaboo misses his hook.
Oh, that was a pretty key death right there. Peekaboo gets caught out and dies. Huge pick for CJ Entis. Now, can someday get away? Has to use the Righteous Glory. Helper now. Now, can they get a Baron out of this? Peekaboo's going to be up just in time for the Baron to spawn.
Yeah, I think CJ Entis needs to defend their middle lane right now. And, you know, as we said, this, you know, as we were kind of talking about, this is KT's game to lose. They can't make more mistakes like that. Peekaboo tried to go for that big play and then ended up paying for it because he missed his hook.
Yeah, Peekaboo has been caught out a couple times this game, even though he's also created some opportunities, but... And right here, it doesn't really matter if he dies because the inhibitor's down and there's nothing to take. So it's actually okay for Peekaboo to take that risk in this particular situation because there's no punishment for it. But still, you know, maybe a bit on the risky side.
Well, we'll see what CJ can maybe convert out of it. I think they're just going for the vision control. They're taking out these pink ward. That's a lot of pink ward that's going to be taken out by CJ Entis. But KT, just Nognate just going to push that mid lane up.
Yeah, and the mid lane wave is going to build. So the inhibitor is going to be under threat from minions unless they walk in to take it out.
KT reestablishing vision control. And just as CJ gets control over vision, they just lose it just as quickly. And KT, Righteous Glory is down. They have a couple seconds in which they can maybe try to turn a play.
Yeah, weird that Righteous Glory was used right there just to walk in towards that Baron.
Oh, Echo has a very good flank opportunity right now. And wow, KT
Rolster. Try and two-man do this Baron. They're going to have to turn. There's Ambition. He gets grabbed immediately. He's not on the flank. Ambition has to zip out of there thanks to the Sivir ultimate. But here's Score. He's in the back line. He's going to die very quickly. Actually has to use his Chrono Break to get out of that one. Bad Life moving forward. Has his ult on. Ambition caught again. There comes Score with the phase dive. There's the Chaos Storm. Not really going to hit much of anyone. Arrow not taking a lot of damage. Someday, afraid of the flank, gets slowed. And Someday using that Arcane Smash to get the slow in return. There's the Lantern. He's going to escape.
Very even fight.
Yes, surprisingly, actually, considering that started with Ambition in a really rough spot.
And Helper didn't use his ultimate at all, so I feel like maybe, if CJ Entis can get Helper to use his ultimate.
Well, Nognate has an ult available, too.
Yeah.
So they're going to ping, actually, the Baron again. KT's going to take another shot at it,
they
it would
seem. They can threaten it just, yeah, very easily. And, you know, Helper, Mininar.
Here's no CP. Good. They're going to use it on the Baron. Mad Life is here, but this Baron's going
to
go down super
Helper
fast.
TP in. Here he goes.
And there we go. Ambition going to get locked up with the hook. There's the Baron. Goes over to Score. Can CJ turn this fight around now? Ambition has the Maokai on top of it. Maokai very low. Someday has
Peekaboo's
to flash
very
out.
Low. Helper's
Helper
in the back.
On the side.
Oh.
But there he goes. Nice star. Peekaboo's going to die. And
well
Helper
played.
Is still alive and available. Azir ult used to block off the choke. And that is going to be a Baron for two members. Again, KT takes the Baron but loses two.
Yeah, and you know, I think CJ Entis is going to easily take this mid-tier one and possibly the tier two. No, actually, they're probably not going to be able to get the tier two, but they can establish control over the dragon that's coming up in 1 minute.
Yeah, but it's only going to be their third stack so far. Azir is still up, so they can't actually force this down. If Azir had died, it would have been a different story.
Mm-hmm.
Helper also has to be sent back. So KT taking a risk right there, thinking they can get that Baron. Now they get it. And now they're probably going to be able to get this dragon and the mid inhib. So I think that trade was actually definitely worth it for KT, depending on how much they can get.
Yeah.
So as we see Someday onto Ambition, not really the ideal target, though. He needs to tie up Coco more than anyone else. And Score just getting Gnar'd into the wall. Nognate, again, still had the Emperor's Divide, so he's able to prevent CJ from getting any more damage done to his team.
Meanwhile, KT Rolster, oh
Helper.
Dear, Helper.
Helper. Helper going to live, actually. Arrow can't go any further forward, but someday can. He's going to lock up Bad Life.
Ambition
Bad Life.
Flank.
Ambition's coming in from the rear. Score is also there, but there's nothing that's going to stop this Vayne from taking this inhibitor. You see someday just waiting behind to see if they can get Ambition. Score going to chase him off.
Well, Ambition running away. He's going to run past that pink ward, so he is seen. They know where he is. But that dragon is coming up, and that is probably going to be a fourth stack for KT Rollster.
Is it? Someday's injured, and Helper has full HP. Helper going to get grabbed to start the fight again, but Arrow only gets two procs down. Nagne has been poked a little bit also. I don't know if Peekaboo wants to do this.
Big
there is
flank.
A good ultimate. Ambition, though, is going to get out. Is he? He's going to get hit by the stun from Echo. Echo is not going to be able to do much. Helper still rolling through. Helper in the Meganar form.
And
that's a trade for CJ. KT overplaying their hand at that dragon.
Ambition is playing these fights at the knife's edge. He starts it off, he goes so low, but manages to live.
Every single time. And we talked about Ambition needing to get those flanks. He's been delivering in this game.
Yeah, much better Evelynn play than before. Let's look at this fight again. Well, Ambition, four-man ultimate.
Yeah, great ult, but Someday and Nagne are already chunked out. Meanwhile, CJ had the chance to go heal. So Score does get a really good stun in from the parallel convergence, but it's countered immediately by the gravity field from Coco's Victor, also well-placed.
Coco's doing so much damage in these fights. Someday melted, even through his ultimate.
Yes, that's a big problem. We talked about the emphasis on armor from this composition that KT has. They have three Frozen Hearts, and only now, just now at 45 minutes, is this locket done.
Well, Thresh currently is sitting on just two items, so... Well, we see the Righteous Glory on the Alistar. We see the Frozen Heart on Evelynn. This game has suddenly turned into a very close one.
And that Frozen Heart is absolutely huge.
Yeah.
That shuts down so much of KT's potential damage.
Especially since Ambition is sitting just right in the middle of KT Rollster in these fights as well.
Yeah. Making sure to get that aura down. KT still with the super minion pressure, but there's enough items that CJ is able to clear out these super minion waves very efficiently.
Yeah, and Madlife looks like he's going for the Mikhail's Crucible just so he can protect Coco in the backline. And I think it's a good buy just because Coco is so much of their team's damage right now. And Sivir, very good items right now. Five core items, six item Sivir right now. Vayne is still working on the last item.
Yeah, that Infinity Edge, pretty crucial as a final item for this Vayne. That will kind of put her over the top. Of course, Arrow was prioritizing the Veil first before getting any additional damage. Mm-hmm. It's actually caused some situations where Arrow was kind of one auto attack away from killing Helper and hasn't been able to finish it off.
You know, at this point, do you think Coco should maybe sell his Abyssal Scepter for maybe a Zhonya's Hourglass?
Ooh. That's a tough call because he's not really getting auto attacked by the Vayne.
Yeah, but it is some added safety for this Kate from against this KT composition that's probably going to try to dive him.
Yeah, the Maokai is really what you have to be concerned about in that instance, and that would buy him a little bit more time.
Yep, Helper just going to eat that hook with his Banshee's Veil. And CJ, the pressure is turned. CJ is applying pressure on KT. KT now looking to be on the back foot. And the gold, still 4K up, but at this point in the game, that 4K gold lead doesn't really mean that much.
No, certainly doesn't. It's going to come down to whether Arrow can get that big-time damage out with the Vayne. Mm-hmm. He has the Infinity Edge now. He finally got it, so we do see that six-item Vayne for this probably apocalyptic Baron fight, coming up. Now, KT is going to have the advantage just due to the inhibitor being down. Mm-hmm.
But I think it should be up fairly soon, so maybe that advantage may not last very long. But we'll see if it's up within 50 seconds. We didn't get a good look over on
it. CJ has no wards, though.
Yeah.
KT has a chance to set up a very good pick right now. And as good as the Gnarlt is, Barry, the score is, because there are so many melee members in the front line, of CJ. Score has a very easy time hitting parallel convergence for another big stun. So it's kind of like big stun countering big stun when it comes to these engagements.
And he's been consistently hitting 2- and 3-man stuns with his parallel convergence. And I don't know like which team I'd favor in a choke fight.
It's both a tough call. Yeah. I mean, both of these teams are very good in the late game, so.
Oh, Madline is caught out. He has to flash.
Has to use his ult, too.
No, his
ult is just his flash.
Yeah,
that was his roar, actually. It's hard to tell when he's that big.
And Madline forced back, but that inhibitor is back up. Baron is now live. Dragon coming in minute 20.
CJ has no eyes on this Baron, either.
Yeah.
There we go, just popping the little orb ward.
Well, CJ saving grace is that they have that one ward in that pixel brush right now. And, you know, Helper's just applying so much pressure in that bottom side. And some days just trying to keep up.
Score, looking for a possible pick. He's going to find Madlife just to hit him with a time winder. He doesn't have a lot of backup. That's quite dangerous. The gravity field going to go through the choke. Score not hit by the death ray.
Yeah, and as big as Madlife is on that all-star.
TP, they're going to go on to Coco. They're going to try and get the hit. Someday there in the back line. He comes through. TP coming through with her helper as well. Ambition caught out of the front line. He's trying to stop them. Had his ult down. Someday already quite low. There's the crowd control coming in from Peekaboo. Gnar is still there. Gnar is still alive. Vayne is by herself. Vayne's going to flash the Gnar ultimate. But Space manages to take out Thresh. It's a 1-0 right now. There's the slow. Can they get more? Space coming through. Emperor's Divide, but they're going to go right onto this Baron.
So many ultimates used. And Ambition, once again, living by a sliver of health.
Ambition had a great ult to stop them from actually engaging onto Coco. That means CJ is going to get this Baron. There is no contest. KT wanted to make the play, and they couldn't actually pull it off. It's also going to be Dragon number 4.
Yeah.
For CJ Entis, so they're getting right on the brink. CJ living and dying by this late game shot calling.
You know, move over, Jhin Air Greenwinds. We have the new kings of the late game and CJ Entis.
Well, they pulled it off. They beat Jhin Air 2-0 last time around.
Old Nogne looking for something. And yeah, CJ gets it. 4 dragons to 3.
CJ just responded so well to that because it was a very surprising teleport for Someday to try and get onto the victor. As we check this out, they thought they could create a pick because Space and Gnar were not there, Helper, but the gravity field buys enough time and there's no damage. Ambition bottles everyone else up in the tri-brush and there's just nothing they can do to actually finish him off. And Space gets there in the end, gets a zoned out just a little bit, but does make sure that he helps out his team, just jogs straight up into that top side.
You know, we haven't talked that much about it, but Space's positioning in these fights has been very, very good, and scoreline shows it 7-2-3. You know, most Sivers we see low amount of kills but high amount of assists, but, you know, I think Space just putting out that damage, cleaning up in these fights.
Well, especially because of all the armor. That's what's even more impressive is that KT is a team that itemized very heavily into armor this game, but they still are managing. CJ's still managing to get those kills onto Space.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're firmly in six-item territory for both teams. Sightstones still haven't been upgraded to Ruby Sightstones. We'll see if that comes next. But Ambition may be looking to get another big armor item, possibly a Guardian Angel. And with how close the edge he's been playing these fights, that Guardian Angel could be very big.
Yeah. Yes, it could. Well, it's been a wild ride through this best of three so far. Extremely close matches. Mm-hmm. CJ showing some nice comeback potential. KT's just going to have to give up this tier two. They can't defend. But there's a lot more tier twos for CJ to go through. And the fact that CJ hasn't really gotten very many turrets this game means that KT can just wait out this Baron more than likely.
And, you know, Someday goes in on Helper.
Oh,
Helper
taking a lot of Vayne damage early. Now, Arrow in the back gets onto Ambition.
He's
and Madline is in the front line still. Uh-oh, KT turning this around. There is Nogne killing Coco. This is probably going to be a KT. Arrow ulting down the mid lane right now. Ambition pops his ult. A little
Space
bit late, but Space is all alone and dead. And KT can probably just charge through. The carries are dead. The wave clear is gone. as Someday finally finds the pick onto Helper on the mid lane. Arrow just moving through the enemy team.
Yeah, and you know, CJ Anthas can't wave clear this. They can't contest this. All the damage dealers for KT is up. What is KT going to do? They're just waiting for that minion wave to come in.
Yeah, they don't even really need it. I mean, Maokai is so tanky right now, but they're still just waiting.
They're hesitating.
Well, there's still 40 seconds. They have a lot of time. So they're going to try and get the damage down, but
they're
just a little bit afraid at the moment. They have a big minion wave. They have to end here if they don't want this to go even longer.
Oh boy, this is looking very
parallel
dicey.
Convergence means they're going to get one turret. And here they go on to number two. There is the exhaust onto Helper. Gnarl not really doing much of anything. Arrow still there. That's going to be it. They focus down the Nexus. KT will take game two. And it comes down to one play in the mid lane. Very back and forth action so far tonight. 11 to 11 in terms of kills. And KT barely pulls it out.
Yep. CJ just digging themselves into a hole in the early game and mid game. They don't need to play this stressfully in the late game, but I mean, still very good shot calling in the late game. One mistake though, when you make it that late,
yeah,
that'll cost you that game. And Coco just refreshing himself.
Wow. Well, a victory for KT Rolster, Nagne's first game in a week or two, and he comes back with a nice performance on that Azir and Nor. Anyone else for CJ? And we've had two games really go down to the wire so far tonight.
Yeah. Well, we will see what the bans are. KT Rolster immediately, Ezreal gone.
So are they going to ban that Rumble again? They banned Ezreal, Rumble, and Annie last time they were on the blue side. Blue side bans for CJ were Kalista, Gragas, and Ryze.
I'm not sure if the Rumble's worth a ban, to be honest. Like, they could possibly let Helper have it. Yes, he got some good equalizers, but
I'm not sure about that, because Helper was caught out in the late game and also died in that 1v1 to Arrow, so it seems like they found ways to abuse Helper's Gnar positioning.
Well, Kalista gonna be the standard red side ban from CJ Entis. And Annie taken out.
So, question is that Rumble going to be last? Will the Gragas be banned against Scorch? I thought it was a little weird that CJ banned the Gragas last game. That's not really a Scorch champion that we see very often. In fact, normally it's KT that bans Gragas and just has Scorch go onto the Evelynn or the Rek'Sai or in now, I guess, the Ekko.
I think the idea may have been to maybe possibly just force Scorch onto a specific champion of their choice in the jungle. But Ryze will be the next ban.
Okay. So, to Rumble or not to Rumble? That is the question.
Yeah. And, you know, another question is CJ Entis really going to let Score have his third game on Ekko? Because he's been playing very well on it. And Ambition, no slouch himself at that jungle Ekko.
Yeah, he's played it before. So, there will be the Rumble ban coming in last. Or do they leave up the Gragas and say, well, you can go ahead and have that Ekko, but we're going to take the Gragas instead.
Mm-hmm. We'll see what CJ Entis decides to choose right now.
Long talk with, of course, Helper there on the end, and there's Coach Sun on your screen right now. He's been the longtime coach of CJ, used to be the primary coach of CJ Blaze.
Yeah, and the Gragas is the ban for CJ Entis, and KT Rolster thinking of what they want. Are they going to go with the Azir first pick again? It seems like it worked out.
You have to keep it away from Coco. There's no other choice here, I think, for KT. And, you know, Nagne played it very well.
Yeah.
He was clutch in those team fights, getting the good ultimates onto Space and Coco to get the kills and turn around some of those 5v5 engages, so there's no reason to not pick up that champion again.
Yeah. I would like to see Ambition on the Ekko, but I think it's better to put him on the primary engage champion rather than Helper, just because Helper is the newer and less experienced member of this team. So I do think that the Evelynn is an okay pick. What else? The same picks and bans, I guess.
Are we just going to see an identical draft to the last game? Alistar and Evelynn coming through. And so, of course, will it be Ekko and Thresh? That was the picks from
Glitch of the Matrix.
KT last time, and CJ's like, do over, guys, do over.
Yeah.
We had that game. We just made that one mistake late.
Remake.
Score. Maybe switching it up to the Rek'Sai against the Evelynn, of course. That is usually the common pick that we see, but no.
Yeah,
why
take,
do that?
Why,
when you
change
take,
it?
Why change when you could take Echo and Thresh? KT's just going to say, no, we won last game. I really don't think you need to take the Echo right now. He's not going to be used in another lane. Just take the Maokai, because his score is just laughing right now. Yeah, we just need to do it again.
And if they do make the same exact picks and they win again, it could be a big statement, to be honest. Gonna go for the swag points.
Well, we've seen some of these matches in best of three. Sometimes we haven't seen identical picks. We've seen one champion changed from game to game.
Well, Coco wants to break out of it with the AP Rammus bid, with the Runeglaive maybe.
No, Runeglaive Rammus, the dream.
That would be
all right,
really funny.
Gnar and Sivir were picked up in this round of the draft for CJ. Now, I criticized them. I said, if you're just going to pick Victor anyway, just pick Victor here.
Yeah.
And counter pick for Helper. So I would say, just clean up the draft a little bit. Sivir, Victor. Do it. Do it, CJ.
I don't know about this Gnar. Take the Maokai.
It just
here.
Seems like a lot of stress to put a new player on a champion that requires so much communication with the rest of your team. And mismanagement of the rage bar is what costs the team the game. This time, it will be a Kog'Maw instant lock.
Yeah.
So we're changing things up a little bit, and that probably means a different AD carry. Now, I think KT took the Victor away, or took the Kog'Maw away, because CJ was setting up here to maybe take the Kog'Maw themselves.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. And I would take the Kog'Maw over the Sivir in that lane matchup, personally. Yeah, I would take the Kog'Maw over the Sivir in that lane matchup. So, will CJ Entis continue and take that Sivir into possibly a losing matchup?
Yeah, I don't think you take that Sivir into the Kog'Maw lane. And they're really limiting CJ's options. So CJ, they show all of this AoE CC from Gnar and Evelynn and Alistar, and they said, hey, we want to play this matchup, and we're just trying to set up for a Protect the Kog comp. And then KT turns back around and says, no, we're going to deny this. Now they take the Shen, a champion that someday was quite successful with in their last match against Najin.
And, you know, it just adds another layer to that protection for Kog'Maw, that big shield that comes up from the Shen ultimate, and a lot of plays that could potentially be made. Corki is the current hover. Pretty decent lane versus the Kog'Maw.
Of course, the big flaw for KT, no primary engage this time.
Yes.
There's no Maokai anymore to really get in there and make those kind of plays that KT was making last time. This is much more a Protect the Kog'Maw kiting composition. But they're used to that. They've been playing. They played Kog'Maw two games against Najin, and they did. They actually executed it quite well. But they need to get to the Dragon first. They need to have priority over Dragon. And frankly, that's been a problem for them early this series. Getting to Dragon first has not been their forte so far. So CJ's going to be on the Corki instead, so they have good poke with Victor and Corki. They also have the superior engage with the Alistar. And the Evelynn following up into a Gnar ultimate. So CJ a little bit more flexible in terms of how they can play the map. KT, if they can force a kiting situation, will be spectacular. So much zone control, so much CC, but they have to be moving backwards to really effectively use it, unless they're going to rely on something like a Thresh hook to start a pick.
Or maybe even just the Azir, you know, doing the Shuriman Shuffle with the Shen coming in on top of it. That would be actually very good engage.
And you know what? CJ's a team that knows how to do that. So they're not going to be surprised by this, because that has been CJ's trick this season, has been Azir Shen.
Yeah.
Using the all-in with the Azir ultimate and the Shen shield on top of him to set up a play, because conveniently, if you time it right, everyone ends up in a line at the end of the Azir ultimate, and they actually just sets you up for like a perfect taunt across two or three people.
Yeah. Well, we'll see if CJ Entis can play maybe a cleaner early game, because Coco just got so denied off of that blue buff, and he needs that blue buff to apply the pressure to really allow Ambition freedom to go into the enemy jungle.
That's right. Well, we're going to load into Game 3 now between KT Rolster and CJ Entis. Similar styles of compositions. Who's going to win and take this series home?
Once again, big cheers from the fans and five-man stack for KT Rolster as they just look to establish deep wards, I think.
Yeah, KT's really going to want the 2v2 with this Kog'Maw. KT just waiting, actually. They're trying to bait in. It's a very unusual bait, but they think that CJ wants to get those deep wards to take that red buff.
Meanwhile, CJ doing an invade on the enemy blue side of their own, getting in deep wards on this side. They're gonna do it fairly well, and KT will know.
Oh, they're gonna see Mad Life right now.
Yep. So they know where the wards are now.
So the brush hide, not as effective as KT would have liked, and in fact, that's gonna deny them from really getting any information at all. That is the risk to playing so passively or trying to set up a trap, is you just don't get good wards down.
It was a good try, I think.
Sure, and they have so much crowd control too. Even though there's an Alistar on the other team, I mean, multiple people getting flayed and then taunted would probably be a pretty bad situation there for CJ Entis.
Yeah, and potentially a parallel convergence on top of that.
That is very true. We have seen Echoes at level 1 pull off the parallel convergence.
Especially if they have a stack like that too. It's going to be big. Well, CJ Entis looks like will be a standard lane setup.
Now they know what's coming. They should have seen Thresh and Kog'Maw on the wards walking to lane, but it's going to be too late really for CJ to respond unless they want to lose some experience and go around the long way and not have a freeze. So KT gets the lane matchup. They will be able to use the Kog'Maw range early on, but there's still, it's not the end of the world. There's still a lot of sustain with the Alistar, so.
Yeah.
And you have the Foss Bomb early to maybe get in a trade or two, but other than that, should be a nice lane for Arrow.
Someday, it's level 2, TP's into the bottom lane. Oh, sorry, I lied, that was Helper, and someday we'll mirror that. So, standard lanes.
Oh boy, Barry.
Oh boy, we get the mano-a-mano, the gentleman's duel.
Gentleman's duel, where you throw boomerangs and swords at each other.
Yep.
That doesn't sound very gentlemanly, Barry.
Maybe
gentlemen don't throw swords.
What do they do? Shoot pistols at each other?
No, you could have a sword fight. You just don't throw your sword. Why would you intentionally disarm yourself?
Well, maybe
gentlemen are trained better than that.
Maybe your swords come back to you, just like Shen's do.
They don't come back. It just throws them, and a new one appears. I have never seen a Shen sword come back.
Maybe it just happens off screen when you're not looking. They're just all in a pile on the ground, and just when you look away, whoop, all the way back into the scabbard.
Yeah, see, that's how many swords does Shen leave on the map while he's actually in this game? Just like, it's so dangerous. You can't be barefoot on Summoner's Rift when Shen's in the game.
Well, thank God that they wear all these boots.
You have to get the boots for Shen's sword protection more than anything else.
Yep. Well, Score gets his blue buff.
Is that your favorite part of the game?
Score getting the blue buff. Well, he's been getting a lot of them this game.
He certainly has been getting a lot of them this series.
Well, Helper up a level, gets the stun. Doesn't want to get more damage on him. A little bit afraid of where Score might be. No information on where he is. Oh, mid lane. We see Azir with the CS lead once again. And we're going to look at some stats as well. 15-5 on Kog'Maw.
Yeah, it's always been a big pick for Arrow, but the really surprising one is Space's lackluster Corki.
I think that's including the stats from CJ's big face. What was it? When they fell flat in Season 4. I think that is an all-time record, so.
I could look it up real quick, but I'm pretty sure that it's going to be accurate for his champion scores at the very least. Ambition wants to go. Score's only level 3. Parallel Convergence going to come in. He is going to get the phase dive just to zone. And no follow-up, really. Nagne Gets his back taken care of by Score.
Still a favorable trade for Coco, I think.
Yep, definitely was. Score is going to start to harass Ambition. He hits level 4 right now. Space actually gets grabbed, and no follow-up on the trade, though. Madlife with a nice headbutt, but a good play. Madlife taking a lot.
Looked good at the middle of that, and Score sees Ambition.
Yeah, he does. He's going to get the drop on him, actually. Oh, the face check, and there's the hate spikes coming out. Some of those passive procs. Ambition actually taking a lot of damage here. Ambition has to flash. Score still has his flash available. How far does he want to push this?
Well, he had
not
the Scuttle Crab.
Enough. So, yes, had the Scuttle Crab speed. Yeah. And now Peekaboo just going to chain the Coco together. Whoa. Lots of damage, and that's what Peekaboo does. He'll just wander out of lane, and Arrow can see us from pretty far away with that Bioarcane Barrage. So he is okay to just to be left in that top side, losing in terms of CS, but they got two summoners out of Coco on that roam.
Yeah, and that was such an odd time to be exceeding that
thresh. Very weird. Well, you don't expect, you just were chasing, you're trying to help your ally get out of there, and you don't expect a Thresh just to show up in your lane, walk up to you, and hook and flay you.
Yep, and, well, Madlife gets a good pulverize, and they just want to push this into the turret and possibly deny some CS.
Yeah, and there's a big wave right there, though, so Arrow should be able to get back within about 5 to 10.
Good damage and delay onto Nagne. He could lose a wave to his turret, I think, if Coco decides to push hard.
Score just going to wait there. Ambition wants to get some counter jungling done at the moment. He will be found out by Score, and neither player has Smite yet. They're going to have Smite at about the same time. Yeah, Ambition doesn't want to mess with this one. Score just wants to go farm under the turret and start to catch back up right there. Someday, you know, he doesn't have that wave clear early on, does have that problem getting harassed just a tad, but starts with the Doran's shield. And so he's going to at least have a little bit of sustain. And
still up in CS as well. So Someday, I think, is in a good spot right now. The tower hadn't taken much chip damage either. All right. Well, Peekaboo moving around, as he usually does.
Yeah, it gets seen, so we'll be pinged out. They have some good deep wards on the top side if they need to. Make sure they know where Peekaboo is, which is definitely an important facet of playing against a Peekaboo. Mm-hmm. Oh. Arrow really suffering in terms of CS, and this is the price. There is that price. Obviously, Arrow was never a great player when it came to farming, and when Peekaboo's with him and Peekaboo is wandering all over, Arrow has to necessarily be denied a little bit in that situation. And when he's on this Kog'Maw that really needs that farm to get to the late game, that may delay a power spike here. Possibly for KT Rolster in a situation where pre-6 they should have had the advantage on the Corki and been able to push him out just a little bit harder.
Yep, Pink Ward snuffed out by Ambition before he gets onto that red buff.
He's scared.
Yeah, Nagne's moved up there.
He really doesn't want to do that right now. Peekaboo can roam in. He's actually going through Tribrush, and they don't know exactly where Score is. They haven't seen him yet. So there's a possibility that he could be walking around the red buff also, which is why they're playing so cautiously at the moment. Peekaboo goes again. You know, that is risky, because if CJ calls their bluff and Score isn't there, then maybe you lose something for that. But they get the wards in again. KT just very good about sneaking deep wards into the enemy jungle.
Yep, and KT pushed up in the top lane. Ambition gets his red buff, but he is low.
Well, they want to make a play right now. On this gen, they have one more global than CJ Entis does. So by prioritizing using that Shen ultimate early and often, they can force a TP advantage and then make more plays and snowball from there. You really, when you have this Shen in the bottom lane, you really just want to go nuts on the enemy team, because you're going to have that ability to make plays on the opposite side of the map more than twice as frequently as your enemy top laner.
Yeah, I feel like this might be an okay game to get maybe Frozen Mallet on the Gnar just to really keep that Shen under control.
That's a very good point.
But I don't think this might, this probably isn't going to be a one of those Frozen Mallet Black Cleaver games.
Probably not, that is true.
But I think Frozen Mallet probably a very, very good buy against this KT team. But yeah, while Helper has has Shen bullied in that bottom lane. It's still even in CS. Really depends on how much damage he's getting on this turret to see if it's really worth it.
Right, and it's hard to make a play yet because neither of our top laners or our AD carries has actually recalled at all.
Yep.
So there's such a small amount of damage coming out that there's not really a great way to make that gank work. But this actually does end up in CJ's favor because the longer they can prevent Shen from getting items, the less dangerous he is going to be. Mm-hmm. And the more reluctant he will be to make cross-map plays.
Helper just really needs to try to chunk out someday so he can't TP or ult away, which he's trying to do right now. But someday using his W very well to prevent as much damage as possible.
Indeed. No more roams from Peekaboo for the instant, for the moment, even though they have a lot of wards. So KT trying to play around this top side right now and get themselves back in the race when it comes to the CC. It's been a really long time without these recalls. We're well behind in itemization between what we would see in this game compared to a normal one.
Yep, and, well, Ambition and top side, possibly looking for a play. They don't know exactly where Score is.
No, they have to be so cautious here. Mm-hmm. The junglers are really the only people with items.
Oh, this is
the taunt, actually. Helper gonna have a chance to hop out of this one. Parallel Convergence not going to land. He is slowed up by the Time Winder. Where's the next taunt? There's a flash coming in. Two flashes for the first blood on to Score, and Ambition just nowhere close to answering that gank. On another lane. So a few summoner spells burned right there, but someday we'll be happy to recall and maybe they can do something else. Peekaboo goes back and you can see CJ just wants to get out of there as fast as possible right now before there's an answering gank onto them in the top side. Because Peekaboo decides to flash Flay while he has a Shen ult on top of him. It could be very bad for Corki and Alistar.
Coco gonna run to Score. Pelican Bridge just goes down.
Doesn't get the stun. There's the Shen ult. They want to get onto Coco. Nocte's going to follow up. Nocte over the wall. Coco actually going to dodge the Azir ultimate. Now Score getting low. Summoner heal going to save him from Nocte. But Nocte gets a kill onto Ambition on the follow-up. Someday will escape. Mad Life there just a little bit too late. And there's not anything else he can do right now. So Coco gets away. But it comes at a pretty dear price of Ambition going down.
Well, CJ once again starting on the back foot in terms of, you know, just pressure, it seems like. But no objectives have been taken, so game's still fairly even.
Arrow starting with Blade of the Ruined King this game instead of going for the Trinity Force.
Maybe they're trying to set him up for a 1v1 versus the enemy top laner? Not sure.
I think they actually just want to sustain against the Corki poke. That would be my guess.
Wouldn't just
here.
The Vamp Scepter be enough then?
Well, you would. Yeah, I would think so, but it would also delay the completion of the Trinity Force. There's also the possibility that they want a team fight with him earlier, and because Gnar is stacking MR and HP right now, the Blade of the Ruined King is going to be incredibly efficient against Gnar.
We'll see.
Without any armor.
We'll see if it pays off soon, but one can only think that the Triforce is probably the next item that will be built by Arrow.
Yeah, certainly. I would assume that was going to be the case. Peekaboo playing aggressively while he has a pink in his try and a Score in the brush as well.
Oh, Peekaboo moving up.
Flay, hook, not gonna hit space.
I think MadLife has started to try to figure out how Peekaboo tends to use his hook after he flays.
Well, he definitely wanted to hook space right there, not MadLife. You don't hook MadLife because MadLife will just pop his ult and walk away.
Right.
So going onto space, the more valuable target.
So looks like KT starting to threaten the dragon. Trying to turn the control wars over on their side. And yeah, well, we'll see in the top lane. The helper has someday pushing it under his turret. He hasn't been getting a lot of chip damage is the thing. He's just really afraid of the Shen taunting him under turret.
I mean, it's a legitimate threat. And he is playing respectfully, perhaps too respectfully. As KT zeroes in on the blue buff.
And now Shen has that Sunfire cape, so he's going to be able to match that push to a certain degree.
Scourge's going to smite away. Yeah, and the Sunfire cape is absolutely that huge item on Shen. You do not have wave pressure before you pick that item up. You have to get it first. If you're delayed and you have to build MR in a top lane matchup, you can run into a lot of problems. But in this particular instance, he's able just to get it because, of course, he's going to build the armor naturally against the Gnar. So now he actually has a way to respond in the end.
Well, not much happening so far.
Nope, just blue buffs being taken by KT. And, you know, this is great for KT. This is how you beat CJ. You shut down Coco. Coco is the big threat. And if you can eliminate him, there's not a lot of help that CJ is going to get. They don't have a big top lane carry these days, even though Helper has been performing pretty well, especially in game one of this series.
Yeah, but now that Rumble's banned and he's on this Gnar, he hasn't been looking as amazing on it. Coco opts not to recall once it's been delayed.
Pikaboo moving around the map. They want to take this dragon before Echo even gets there.
They'll probably get it with the Blade of the Ruined King on Kog'Maw.
It's a great item to start out with because you can tank the dragon and you can get that percent HP. So Score just going to show up for a final smite.
And Nogne is just putting so much pressure in that mid lane right now.
Really good dragon timing for KT. They managed to make it work. And they also had two forms of teleport while Helper didn't have a TP up at all. So super safe, using the recall timing of space to get that dragon. And that means they are finally starting to get the game's early dragons, which they've been struggling with. And someday just going to back off right there. Doesn't want to deal with a possible three-man dive. Has a very smart ward where he at least sees Madlife.
Well, now he knows for sure that Ambition is in the top side, so they'll probably get this turret, I'd imagine.
And again, Coco, no mana. Denied that blue buff, goes over to Nogne. Nogne has the pressure. He has that ability to push into the mid lane, and Coco just has to stand here helplessly and watch his tower get chipped. That's the last death ray he's got.
Well, he has a null magic mantle, so maybe he's adapting and going for the Chalice of Harmony here. Or maybe just going for that Abyssal Scepter early.
I bet he's going for the Abyssal.
Yeah. I feel like the Athene's Unholy Grail would be actually a good pickup at this rate.
I mean, I agree with you. If he can't rely on his team to protect the blue buff, then absolutely you need to get it that regen for yourself. Because otherwise you're going to lose your towers.
And it looks like it will be the Abyssal Scepter with that Blasting Wand by.
Yep, sure will be. A lot more damage onto the turret. And that's going to be used as a recall timing for Nogne. He finishes his Abyssal Scepter.
Yep.
And so he's going to be able to push even further forward right now. The question is, where is Someday going to make his next play?
Someday, he's pushing and pushing. Just these lanes aren't going to break anytime soon, it seems like, Monte Cristo.
No. No, I dare say they will not.
And the longer this goes, I feel like this is turns more and more in favor of KT, even though they have that top lane tower taken.
As long as they don't have to engage. Oh, that's just annoying. Ambition going to steal it with the smite. He does get tangled up. He is taking a lot of damage, especially from that Sunfire cape too. So, but there is a Mega Gnar in the top side to give him a bit of a helping hand, so not going to be the end of him by any means. There's also Pikaboo. Again, look at Pikaboo and Score. Just leave an arrow. Arrow just walks back to the turret. He's like, I'm okay. Wow, Ambition actually has to flash Score. Going in. He's going hard. And there he goes. Goodbye. As Score and Pikaboo flash for a kill. And this is what KT does. They play very weird in your own jungle. This is what Pikaboo has always done. And they give up a bottom tier one for it, though. And that's the question is, are these kills onto Ambition worth it? Because what KT kind of trades dragons and towers for early are buffs and jungle control.
Well,
and not even in this case. Pikaboo's coming back around. He's going to be there with Shen. The Shen ultimate on him. Madlife immediately uses the Unbreakable Will, but Someday's already there, and Helper is just not in a position. And there's a hook. Beautiful. Arrow has a chance to come over. If he needs to, he will. And there is Madlife. Dead. He resigned himself to his fate. Wow, Coco. Just gets found on the outside. There's the Chaos Storm. Ambition is there. Score is coming up from behind. Ambition not going to be able to actually kill Nagne, though, with Score and Someday to back him up.
Well, Nagne saw that he had the item advantage and went for the fight, but Score wasn't there quickly enough to really add that extra damage. And yeah, KT off to a good start. 4-0 up 1,000 gold, so, and
it's
a dragon.
But it's only that 1,000 gold.
Yeah.
It's only that 1,000 gold. They have the dragon, that's great. But KT, it's interesting because what we've seen from them against Najin and against CJ so far is that they really prefer to trade some early objectives. They'll give up a dragon, they'll give up a turret, if it means they can get a buff and a kill and some deep wards in. Mm-hmm. So the vision priority is absolutely crazy right now for them as a team. Because while other teams will not try and take advantage of any kind of opening or not be willing to fight or commit when there's not a dragon on the line, KT will, and I think that's confusing to CJ. Now, is it worth it? Maybe not. Last game, I think it was. As Pikaboo gets caught out a little bit right here, there's Ambition popping the Agony's Embrace. Pikaboo on the run. There's an exhaust to follow up. Coco coming through, and there, Pikaboo trying to save himself with the lantern, but Coco flashing over the wall for the kill.
Good kill.
But they are deep in enemy territory right now. Remember, Someday still has a TP.
Well,
but they're going to get out.
Dragon coming up in 50 seconds, so CJ can use this chance to kind of set up for that dragon. And Gnar just pushing. Story of this game.
CJ losing their mid lane tower, though. That is pretty huge right now for them, especially if they want to try and make a game out of this around the next dragon.
You know, I wonder if it would be worth it for Helper to match Someday's Sunfire Cape with one of his own. Then at least he'll be even in items, and since he was winning that kind of push war already, he'd be winning it even harder.
Yeah, I'm not sure how much that would help in this particular instance. I liked your idea of going for the Frozen Mallet in this matchup. I think that might be quite strong. At least you can win the harassment. So if he actually walks up to the wave, you just hit him with your auto several times and make sure you get that percent HP proc so that he's less likely to walk into the middle of the minion wave.
Well, looks like he's going to get that chip damage onto that turret, but Someday coming back to lane very quickly with the Helm Guard. And a lot of armor on Someday.
Like, Space also ahead. He's got the finished Trinity Force. Arrow does not, but CJ just nowhere near this dragon. They have the Scuttle Crab, but they're not going to fight it.
Yeah, I feel like they just wanted to give that up, maybe farm up a little bit more, maybe catch up Coco a little bit.
Well, as long as KT gets that dragon first and they get in position in the river, CJ should be very reluctant to try and fight them because that Shen ult is going to do a huge amount of work if they can use it defensively instead of offensively. It's so much easier to use that ability while the enemy's engaging into you than to try and time it with one of your allies' engages.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Someday. With the
oh, dear.
The sexy sword throw and then the nice little dodge at the end. The taunt.
Well, pressure starting to turn against CJ, and Nagne starting to roam down. Looks like KT may want to go for a dive on this turret, or at least a big play in the bottom lane, but Nagne seems a little indecisive.
No, I'm not sure they want to do this quite yet. They could try for a five-man dive. They may just try and zone them off the tower. That's what they're going to do. They have the Sheen. Gonna fake it out with the lantern and see how much damage they can get, but Mad Life really not gonna fall for that.
Okay, the tower survives for now. They see Nagne moving back into the mid lane. Is this an opportunity for Ambition in the bottom lane? They know Score's still there.
Yeah, they do. It was a good play from Mad Life, though. He didn't take the bait. They had Victor there, so he felt comfortable trying to defend the turret. That's going to keep it alive for a while longer.
Yep,
pretty important in a very close contest, but CJ is slowly getting more and more and more of a CS advantage, and that's translating now into the fact that they have overtaken KT Rollster in terms of the gold lead in this game.
Well, we'll see if there is a fight that breaks out anytime soon. But it's just farming, farming, farming for both teams.
Well, Arrow really needs that Trinity Force. He has to be able to match Space's power spike. If he wants to be successful in some of these team fights, he'll get it on his way back right now. Does he get the boots? Yes, he does. So running himself out of gold. He's 1,000 gold behind thanks to the extra turret and the fact that Space has managed to get a 40 or 30 rather CS advantage.
Yep. And Coco is going to take the Scuttle Crab as well as, yeah, just Ambition going to recall.
So KT. They have these two early dragons. They are going to be perfectly fine with that. They have the better late game scaling, so the fact that they don't really have to commit to dragon fights for a while will suit them just fine.
So if you're CJ, what do you want to do now? Do you want to go for some crazy dives? But the problem is that Shen is up, and Shen is getting very tanky.
Helper going to try and fight this one. There's a Gnar ultimate, but it's not going to get a stun. Box already dropped to stop them from doing this. There we go. Taunt coming through. Is there more damage? Parallel convergence over the wall. It may is not going to hit the Corki in the end, but that's going to be a lot of disengage. Someday misses his taunt on the return. Now here they're all grouped up. Big Chaos Storm. There's a Shen ultimate to save Pikaboost. Shen just going to taunt over. He's still in the storm. Does get out. Nagde moving forward. Arrow's here. Flash over the wall.
Oh.
Beautiful headbutt from Mad Life, but Arrow has his flash in return, and that means Helper's going to fall, and Mad Life will die in the end as Arrow counterplays the Alistar, and there we go. There's a TP. Someday already back in using his one global, but he's still going to go for this. They want to clear out those vision wards in the pit, and they want to figure out if this Ambition Evelyn is still on the flank, which she is. They have to do this quickly. Helper still has TP.
Yep. And they probably will with the Blade of the Ruined King on the Kog'Maw and Ambition scene.
Yeah, they want to find it. They see Ambition.
Flash.
There's a hook. They catch him out. Ambition is going to fall. Wild Score picks up the Baron. So early Baron from KT Rolster on the strength of that fight. Ambition tried to be sneaky, but Pikaboo managed to find him alongside Arrow, so a quick Baron means 7-1 kills in favor of KT Rolster. And CJ started that fight too.
Yeah.
KT reacted to it. Pikaboo just getting out of the Gnar. This is just, so we didn't actually see the Gnar ult coming in because it had already been used, but Someday just perpetuating this since he knows that key Gnar cooldowns are up. And again, they're fighting around when Helper's about to go into mini Gnar, just like they did at the end of last game. Good ult from Ambition, but Nagne plays this defensively and Someday manages to teleport just out of range. Arrow here is able to do a lot with just the living artillery on the flank, and Mad Life makes a play. That is a great play. Forces the summoner out of Arrow, but also isolates Mad Life in the end.
I feel like, what exactly did Helper die to? Because Arrow killed him, so did Mad Life's play actually put Arrow in range?
That is a good question, actually.
I feel like
I didn't
that's what
that.
It did. Because I don't think he died to the red burn at that point. He had maybe about like 50 to 100 HP, so it wasn't enough for the red burn to just kill him at that point. He was really far back.
Yeah, it's also worth noting that when Mad Life punted Kog'Maw in there, there's no supplemental CC after that. There's no way to instantly lock up the Kog'Maw and keep him from doing damage. Sure, he popped the exhaust on him to cut the damage, but there's nothing to stop him just from flashing back out like he did. So there wasn't a lot of synergy there, even though it looked like at first glance that that Kog'Maw movement was going to be good. If the flash is still up, he gets out relatively easily.
Yeah, and once again, so that fight started out with Helper getting caught out in the enemy jungle. So
well,
Helper...
It wasn't that. They tried to go onto Pikaboo. That was the thing, is that Pikaboo was alone, and Pikaboo turned that fight around by boxing and then flashing out and then Helper burned key cooldowns without getting the stun off on the Gnar. And that's when KT decided to re-engage. So I think that's just a bad judgment call by Helper.
Okay.
To go, because as soon as you get the flash out and the box out of Thresh, you're like, oh, great.
Right,
that's good.
Off.
Yeah, just back out. But by continuing to go in, that was what caused the problem.
You know, I don't understand why he chose to use that Gnar in the direction that he did. Because he just essentially threw them down the jungle away from it and like just parallel to the wall rather than into it. So I think if he had gotten pickable into a wall, it might have been a different story, possibly.
Maybe. I'm not sure that his team was in range to do damage at that stage would be the issue. But yeah, you have to credit KT too. They won last game by playing around Gnar Rage very well. And they did that. They won that team fight and got a Baron with that same level of play.
Well, so. And KT gonna take a third dragon, uncontested. CJ in no position to fight at the moment.
Much earlier ages this game.
Yep.
From score, naturally. And that's a big problem. CJ pretty heavy into the magic damage, so the MR or itemization, even though someday has decided that he doesn't need any for some reason.
This Kog'Maw, 3-0-1, and has almost finished his Last Whisper, so this Gnar is not in a good spot.
Has finished his Last Whisper.
Has finished it, along with the Berserker's Grief, so, you know, Arrow in a very, very good position to just carry this game right now. As long as KT can just keep the Kog'Maw safe, which they very easily can with this composition.
I'm not sold on someday's build here. Not sure you need
that much armor.
I think he just Thornmail yet.
I think he just wants it for the 1v1 split push versus Helper. Because Helper continually hits him, he's just going to be taking that return damage.
But to that I say, Helper has a lot of MR already.
Yeah.
So it's really not going to be doing hardly any damage. I don't know about that one. I think it makes him too vulnerable to the burst from Coco.
Well, hopefully Coco can get that burst down, but he's still down a substantial amount of gold compared to Nagne. And meanwhile, Nagne has three core items.
Ooh, the pick.
There we go, Helper.
Yeah, they want to go up to Arrow. He's already taking a bit of damage, but Helper is taking a huge number. And there's the Shenel right on top of him, someday coming into the fight. Helper very low, but score. He has his chrono break, it's okay. And meanwhile, Space and Nagne scuffle in the jungle.
Yeah. It's ridiculous how much damage this Kog'Maw's doing, especially now that he has that Last Whisper and the Triforce and the Blade.
Here we go, TP coming in. They want to get onto Arrow. Can they do it? Great engage. Arrow gets nearly blown up immediately, and there they go. They get the kill onto the Kog'Maw, shutting Arrow down. Score on the run right now. There he goes. Falls before they can siege the turret. So Helper takes damage, but then immediately TP's back in for a counterplay. Now they have TP disadvantage. How far can CJ push this? The Azir is still up. And there's no dragon and no Baron.
Well, the Azir is going to be zoned out. Helper looking to maybe zone Nagne away. Helper creating that zone. And he gets taunted, jumps away. Has his ultimate up, so they could potentially go for this dive. They have to take this right now. Ambition, take some damage.
Yep, just give up the turret. KT did what they could on the defense. The most important thing is being alive when the Baron spawns. So if all CJ gets out of that is two kills off the pick, but they have no TP now.
Yeah.
So the question remains, how is CJ actually going to contest this Baron when they have no mid turrets, and KT still has two. If KT can just go ahead and siege down this tier one in the top side and then take control of the Baron pit, without the TP, it's going to be really hard. Coco's still down in bottom.
Yep, and someday moving down towards that bottom lane, that wave is pushed up fairly heavily towards the side of CJ. So someday, both globals are up, his ultimate and his teleport.
Well, this should, in theory, be a very easy Baron take for KT as long as they can get priority over the vision. Or Shen is just going to split push rapidly into the inhib turret. So easy times now. And while they did get the kills, that's why you can't use TP like that, especially against a Shen who has twice as many globals as you, because otherwise you find yourself in this situation, and it simply is not worth it.
Well, Shen pushing up. CJ can't afford to send anyone right now towards him because, as just like you mentioned, but Mad Life gets caught.
All right, is Shen going to ult, though, is the question. Shen just staying firm. He's not going to do anything.
He's gonna get
they
turret.
Tried to hard engage it, but they didn't get it. I mean, it's either the inhibitor or the Baron. That's CJ's choice right now. That is the kind of grave they dug for themselves.
This is flashbacks to Season 3, Monte Cristo.
Space going to have to go down and deal with this, but Someday is going to just wait for the next wave. KT has to play this very patiently.
Baron is activated. They're gonna, they can take this very quickly.
They can. Of course, the Kog'Maw and the Azir are there. Score. Going to get the Shen ult onto him, so they're just going to commit to this immediately. A little bit dangerous for KT. They could get this stolen. But they're not going to. Nara's not there. There it goes.
FCJ well, gives up that Baron.
And that is the problem with making teleport plays like the one we saw CJ making, is that you're forced into a really, really rough situation.
And it looks so promising for CJ after they made that, but as you said, just with the Baron coming up that quickly, and now the Dragon up in 30 seconds, will CJ and just be able to possibly take this, or will they be able to take a fight here? Shen ultimate is down, so that is one big cooldown down for KT Rolster.
Doesn't matter, still has teleport.
Right, but like I'm thinking more
the
in
shield.
Terms of the shield of that Shen ult, because it could definitely stop a pick from occurring. And that's what CJ Entis needs. They need a good pick.
So KT lining up for Dragon number 4. Scuttlecrab steal, that's nice for Ambition.
Smite, he has a second charge.
Nope, blind hook, not going to work. Of course, he didn't have vision thanks to the ward being blocked by the sweeping lens. So here we go, pink ward down. They're going to clear out. I'm not sure that's really necessary, actually, because they have the crab, so you don't really need to clear out their wards right there, because they're going to have no vision no matter what you do.
Yeah, and Ambition tried to go for a flank, but that pink ward was in his way. KT has a strong five-man unit. If they want to fight this, CJ needs to go in relatively soon.
Well, W's down for Echo, so that means KZ needs to walk away from this until the Echo W is up again.
So Dragon resets. Bottom wave is pushing in favor of CJ Entis. So the longer they possibly push, drag this out.
Yeah, but this mid lane is kind of disastrous right now. Shen's ult is back up, so KT could just stand here forever. And Helper has CP up now.
Oh,
right
dear.
Now. Ambition's still looking for the flank. There's no pink wards to prevent him from getting it. But there's Someday. And he has Baron minions, so KT just perfectly happy to sit here as long as this takes.
CJ needs to make a decision right now.
Here comes Ambition. There's the TP coming in from the side. They have the home guard. Can they win the fight? They've all in on this. Arrow so safe in the back line, face of the mountain, and the Shen ult on him. He's going to flash back and then keep on auto-attacking. No threat onto Arrow. Arrow is just going to kill everyone after that. KT so ready for that play from CJ. CJ with the Hail Mary attempt. They wanted it, and now Someday, Coco hunting.
Coco tries to run it with the speed boost, trying to delay as much as possible, and dead.
Flashing with the sod. Coco, not looking too happy about that one. Score just going to pop in with the phase dive and see if he can get that last little bit of damage out.
Oh, we're doing a lot of damage.
Yeah, they have to blow Summoner Heal. They should just be going for the win right now. They have Baron-empowered minions. No reason that they have to deal with Helper.
Well, Arrow has no mana right now, but there are four people from KT still in that middle lane.
Yeah, they can't win now. They waited a long time chasing down Coco and Helper, and now Space and Madlife and everyone are back up. No TP, so they can get the Dragon A-OK, but they only got an inhibitor win. I think they may have been able to take just a little bit more.
Well, KT wants to play safe, so they get in position for Dragon number 4, and they take it easily with a big wave pushing at top. That's also a big chunk of gold heading their way as well. Nagne going to pick it up.
Yeah, this is a huge cash-in. It's going to be an Infinity Edge for Arrow, as if he wasn't doing enough damage already.
Oh, dear.
I really like how KT disengaged that fight, though. They were incredibly prepared for what was coming in from CJ. Of course, they could have had a better pink ward on their flank to prevent Ambition from getting in, but CJ was just a little bit helpless, and that was their kind of last chance of getting back into this game.
Well, CJ Entis.
Banner command, on to Someday.
Well, CJ Entis will need a miracle play for sure in order to take the win away from KT Rolster at this point. But with that Banner of Command, as you said, it's looking very, very difficult. Someday split pushing is just going to be that much more potent, and they can easily give up this tier one.
Yeah, but the five-man stack working for CJ.
Shenhold is up.
Shenhold back available. Of course, those Shenhold buffs recently to the cooldown really helping him have that much more presence on the map once again. Big factor into why he's back in the meta.
Oh, Shen pushing and pushing. CJ wants to back off, but I wonder what they're trying to do. Someday we'll steal this blue buff on his own.
He hasn't actually used the banner yet, curiously. CJ wants this, but the glory's been used, and it's not going to find a target. So it looks like everyone from KT just wants to pile on through into the bottom lane and take this last remaining tower.
And CJ forced to take the long way around. And they're going to get decent damage. They're probably going to take this turret right now.
They have a machine. No problem. Oh, Ambition gets hooked and boxed into the side. Score doesn't want to finish off that kill yet, though. They're trying to prevent the flank. Helper's about to turn into Meganar, but how much will it help? Arrow gets stunned in the back, but he's under the Azir turret, and there's the Shenhold. He does die, but Nagde is full HP. They committed so much that is a triple for Nagde, and
Quadra.
That is a Quadra. Is Nagde going to get the Penta?
Oh,
he's coming
someday.
In, they want it.
What?
No,
Penta kill!
And there it is, going back to the turret for the worst Penta kill camera work that I've ever seen. It was so easy, all you had to do was focus on Nagde. Someday land the taunt, and that'll be a Penta for Nagde.
And with that, KT Rolster takes a 2-1 victory in style with a pentakill to top it off at the end. Well played, GG.
Yeah, and is KT still looking a little bit rough as they acclimate a bit to their new roster, of course, making some of those changes. But honestly, very promising. Peekaboo really lending a lot of veteran vision control to this team and showing up big once again on the Thresh. And there he is.
Looking pleased.
At the end, looking very happy.
The amount of pressure that Peekaboo and Score together are able to exert on the map with just their vision, it's insane. I want to see KT up against SKT and see how it matches.